East St. Paul, Minneapolis, Channel 5.
Live from the St. Paul Civic Center Arena. It's the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament pregame show. Now, here's Bob Bruce.
Hello again, everyone. Good afternoon. I'm Bob Bruce, and welcome to Minnesota Mania, that special March Madness known as the Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament. KSTP Television will be on the air all of this afternoon, again tonight, tomorrow night, then Saturday afternoon and Saturday evening, bringing you all of the excitement of the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament. Now, here's a look at what you can expect to see over the next 3 days. The first game of the tournament has first-timer Rochester Mayo of Section 1 facing Section 6 representative Edina. The second game has defending champion Bloomington Jefferson, the only team to return from last year's tournament, taking on East Grand Forks, who at 21-2 has the best overall season record of the teams here in the tournament. Tonight, the opening game of the evening bracket finds Section 4 champion Henry Sibley facing the Blue Jackets of Hibbing, ranked number one prior to this tournament, who finally cracked Grand Rapids' eight-year stranglehold on that title. And in the nightcap, it's David against Goliath, first-timer Cloquet against another first-time team, White Bear Mariner, but the size difference between those teams, dramatic. Mariner, very big. Cloquet, very small, but fast. Those are the matchups. We'll be back in a minute to look at how those eight teams arrived here at the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament right after this.
You'll get 40 to 60% off on hundreds of cross-country skis and boots at North Country's Once in a Blue Moon Ski Sale. Even bigger discounts on used and rental equipment. Biggest sale in 10 years on knickers, sweaters, and jackets. Blue Moon Sale starts Tuesday and closes out Thursday. Sale on a first-come, first-served basis on this closeout of top-quality merchandise. Buy for now or next season at famous North Country Ski. Cross-country specialist, 1.5 miles east of 494 on I-94, East St. Paul.
Lee was the healthiest child you ever saw. And all of a sudden, here comes the leukemia, just out of the clear blue sky.
We're drinking milk and eating meat, you know, that has virus particles.
That conceivably could cause leukemia?
That's right.
New studies show a virus in dairy cows may cause leukemia in man. This is Dr. Michael Breen. Watch this special assignment tonight at 10 on Eyewitness News.
Next on Entertainment Tonight, Oscar winner Glenda Jackson.
In England, it is possible to fail, and you aren't automatically struck off everybody's lists.
And Gene Hackman reveals a lifelong dream.
Something I really have to do before it's all over is go back and do the straight play that I've always wanted to do.
Plus, special guest Donna Dixon on the next Entertainment Tonight.
Thursday at 6:30 on Channel 5.
Hello, I'd like to talk to you about your taxes. Under President Reagan's leadership, Congress has passed the largest tax cuts for working Americans in nearly 20 years. Next year, the average family will pay about $400 less in federal income taxes. I'm asking you to save and invest your tax cut money. There are many ways to save. So why don't you put your tax cut dollars to work building a strong American economy? You'll be doing yourself and your country a big favor. Thank you.
Well, they've opened the doors here at the Civic Center. The fans are starting to file in, and we're about 25 minutes away from the start of today's first game. Eight teams will begin play here today, two of those in the afternoon session, and of course, two more tonight. In the opening game, a newcomer from Section 1 faces a restructured old-timer from Section 6. Here's Channel 5 sports reporter Larry Burnett.
Well, Bob, the tournament is going to start off with a brand new look because a brand new team is in. Rochester Mayo comes in representing Section 1. You know, they used to be Rochester Mayo, the other team in Rochester, but this year they are Rochester Mayo, the team in Rochester, the only team in Rochester going into the state championships.
They reached those championships last weekend by defeating another team making a first-time bid to get to the tournament, Burnsville. In fact, Burnsville opened the scoring so quickly, you'd have thought they were the team destined for St. Paul. It took only 16 seconds for Todd Okerlund to slide the puck to sophomore Todd Skime, who beat Mayo goalie John McCauley. But midway through the first period, Mayo regrouped and Doug Wick, a sophomore winger, scored the first of two goals for the Spartans to tie it at one. And Brad Johnson gave Mayo the lead for good before the period ended when he fought off Burnsville's Dave McNulty to label a shot for the upper right corner. Burnsville started the second period as it had the first, Skime scoring his second and Burnsville's only other goal with a 40-foot shot. But that two-goal tie lasted about 3 minutes when Wick scored his second goal of the game. Later in the third period, Pete Williams added this insurance goal. So Rochester Mayo has a berth in the state hockey tournament for the very first time. Are they ready for tournament-level action?
I never know what these guys are peaking. They're peaking early in the year, middle of the year, who knows? But if they play like this in the tournament, we're going to give everybody a battle.
How do you think you'll fare against either Edina or Wayzata?
I don't know. Edina beat a 6-2 earlier. They've got a super club. We're just going to have to play good hockey. I don't know.
Well, ready or not, Mayo has not drawn the easiest opponent of the tournament. They'll be facing perennial powerhouse Edina and doing it in the supercharged atmosphere of the tournament's opening game. If Edina treats Mayo the way it treated Wayzata in the Section 6 championship game last Saturday, Mayo will be glad it has a clinic to go home to. Edina buried Wayzata 8-1, the most lopsided finish in any section final. Perhaps it was justified. The Hornets finished number one in the Associated Press rankings of high school teams. Edina already had a 3-1 lead in the second period when they decided to put things on ice. Look at what happened in a five-minute span. First, Mike DeVoe scored with help from Dan Carroll and Wally Chapman to make it 4-1. Then, an unassisted goal by Chapman. Then, another by senior center Mike McCarthy. That gave Edina a 5-goal lead, and by high school rule, that lead required the game be played with running time in the third period. In the third period, Edina scored 2 more goals. Now, since Edina East closed last year and Edina West became simply Edina High, Willard Ikola became the public school's head coach. How does he view his consolidated team and the 11th appearance by an Edina team in the tournament?
We have 5 boys that played with Edina West for Coach Larson last year, and those kids are coming back. The other 13 have not been in the state tournament, but those 5 kids from West, they certainly give us the backbone to our team, and you need that experience, especially in a short tournament like the state hockey tournament.
Well, that's today's first matchup, a tournament newcomer against a tournament veteran. And now for the second afternoon game, here's Ed Cairo in Thief River Falls.
One of the teams seeded in the second game of the afternoon bracket of the state high school hockey tournament came from Section 8. And that titleist was decided last week here at Thief River Falls, where Bemidji took on East Grand Forks.
When the game opened, it looked like Bemidji had the upper hand. They buzzed Green Wave goalie Todd Christensen repeatedly. But it was East Grand that scored first. 9 minutes into the first period, Tim Mishler assisted on this goal by Jim Derrick for the early lead. But less than 2 minutes later, the Lumberjacks started grinding their own axe. Kevin Church scored to square the game, and the tie held through the end of the first period. In the second, the game slowed, both teams playing a cautious, tentative game, except Mishler getting a stick on a free puck just after his team was denied a goal on a power play. The Green Wave was up 2-1. In the third period, Bemidji was getting desperate, and they moved in hard on Christensen but couldn't convert. On the other end of the rink, Bemidji's Brian Grand was fighting hard, making great saves to keep the Lumberjacks in it. But finally, they pulled Grand for an extra attacker, and Mishler drilled the puck into an empty Lumberjack net for the 3-1 win, and East Grand Forks returned to the tournament after appearing in 80 and sitting out in 81.
I think we can have a good showing. You know, we're going to go down there and play our game, and hopefully things will work out for us. We're going to give it our best, and we're very happy to be there.
You've got to wonder just how very happy East Grand Forks was, though, when they learned they'd open against the defending state champion. Bloomington Jefferson became the repeat Section 5 titleist at Met Center last Saturday, but they had to overcome their own jitters and an emotional and talented Bloomington Lincoln team, a school and a hockey program in its last year of existence. So it was that Lincoln scored the first goal of the game. Winger Larry Lehman, unassisted. And the second. In the second period, Tom Gertis feeding Mike Murphy for a 2-goal lead. Jefferson might have started to doubt itself at that point, but they didn't. And a relentless hounding of the puck paid off late in the second. Steve Bianchi, one of the Jags' senior tri-captains, scored at 13:50 to reduce the Jefferson deficit to 1. In the third, the Jaguars started to roll a little. Terry Sullivan got the goal that put them back to scratch, tied at two. Then Lincoln's Dan Daggett put the Bears ahead again. But what followed was a 2-minute, 14-second explosion in which Bianchi scored again, and Lee Fjellman scored the game winner and an insurance goal to send Jefferson back to St. Paul to defend its state title. The Jaguars have been hounded all year with the question, will you repeat? Now they're back, and they may finally be able to relax and play their game.
I hope so. You know, we've been there before, and these kids have been there. Robbie and Steve have been there three consecutive years. I hope so.
So that wraps up the afternoon pairings for today's first round of the tournament. Let's go back to Bob Bruce.
Well, a rookie team, a veteran team, a defending champion, and a relatively new entrant. I'll tell you, we're going to have some exciting games this afternoon. We'll check the nighttime schedule in just a moment.
Checkmate by Good Sports. Get the ultimate in mid-body protection. Thighs, kidneys, and hips fully protected by lightweight Checkmate. With the fit you can customize. Good Sports shoulder pads mean super protection of the AC joint, sternum, and collarbone. Join the hockey revolution with Good Sports, the ultimate in protection. Get Checkmate and all the other great equipment from Good Sports. Good Sports hockey equipment is available at better sporting goods stores everywhere.
It's been a tradition for nearly 100 years. From the Babe right up to today's players, spring means one thing, a time to get into shape for the upcoming baseball season. This is Bob Bruce. The Twins move to the new Metrodome in just a few weeks with their youngest team ever. How good will they be? Who are these young players? Starting Monday, we'll find out in a special series of reports from the Twins spring training camp in Orlando, Florida. Watch spring training starting Monday at 6 and 10 on Eyewitness News.
From the old Cowtown Museum in Wichita, Kansas, and all across the Midwest, Country Day brings you closer to the country. Closer to agriculture with farm marketing and production pointers on AgReport. Closer to rural living with homespun information and homegrown facts cooking right from your own kitchen. And closer to your friends and neighbors in the heart of America with reporters shooting the breeze over a back fence that stretches clear across the nation. So come closer to the country with Country Day weekday mornings on this station.
I'm Diana Nyhead, and I hold the world record for the longest swim in history, from the Bahamas to Florida, 89 miles. You don't have to swim 89 miles to help the Red Cross. You can swim once across the pool, twice, or as many times as you can make it. I think the Red Cross puts on the most important water safety programs in this country, and you can help by calling your local chapter and joining the Swim Across. This is a public service announcement brought to you by Channel 5.
Well, we have a team making its fifth state tournament appearance, another making its sixth, and two more rookie teams slotted into this evening's opening round action of today's tournament. To find out how they got here, let's find out more about those teams from Rob Lear.
The Section 7 berth in this year's state tournament was decided between two northern Minnesota backyard rivals, Hibbing and Grand Rapids, here at the Old Memorial Auditorium in Hibbing. All seats have been sold for this showdown weeks ago. After all, this date and time in March has become an annual send-off celebration for the Grand Rapids hockey fan since the early 70s. But this year, the home team Hibbing had different ideas and a more meaningful motive. Their coach George Perpich had promised this trip across the ice was going to be his last. From the outset, Hibbing was the team of opportunity. Grand Rapids, a team in trouble. The perennial Section 7 power of the 70s obviously lacked that offensive and defensive threat that had carried them to eight state tournament berths in a row. Hibbing would score five goals this night, a pair by Greg Hooper, one by his brother Gary. Hockey at Hibbing has become somewhat of a family affair that needed some pregame convincing to end this Rapids reign.
Finally, someone had to do it, and I'm sure glad we did.
Coach George Perpich, a sweet victory and rewarding way to go out on top.
Now you go in there as the coaching veteran. Everybody's going to be looking for you.
Oh, I know that.
You're going to show them a few tricks.
I don't know whether I'll show them any tricks. I think it's too late to change now.
That kind of old but reliable approach will be on the line against the winner of Section 4. as predictable as the overflow crowd that jammed into the St. Paul Auditorium last Friday night to watch the finals of this Section 4 championship game between South St. Paul and conference foe Henry Sibley. The game script itself that had followed, an old-fashioned St. Paul shootout. Goals were scored this night from every conceivable angle by both sides. Defending champ South St. Paul scoring first. Henry Sibley rebounding to tie 1-1 at the end of one, 3-3 by the end of two. By trading goals and blows all night long, you sense just how important this section's off-season bragging rights really are. At the outset of the third period, Sibley was hot. Paul Kayser dribbled one in for the lead. Then 2 minutes later, Mason Lees shuffles one in for insurance, a policy Sibley would cash in before game's end in order to win. South St. Paul's Phil Housley, the senior sensation headed for stardom, was able to pull the Packers back within a goal with 5 minutes to play. But that was as close as the Packers would get. An open net goal clinched for Sibley and coach Joe Civic a rewarding trip to the tournament, Sibley's first since 1976.
They haven't been there for 6 years, and the kids are just going to rise to the occasion and they're going to give everything they've got. I think we're just going to be a hustling club, and that's about it. We're nothing fancy. We get the job done, though.
Henry Sibley and Hibby in the evening brackets opening game. For the day's final matchup, let's go to Section 3 and Ed Cairo.
24 hours later, in the same jam-packed St. Paul Auditorium, it was deja vu in the Section 3 championship game from last year. The combatants were the same, White Bear Mariner and North St. Paul. But the outcome was mirror image. This time it was the Dolphins who prevailed in what turned into a lopsided victory. The first period ended tied at one, but the second was riddled with Mariner goals. The period started and ended with goals by senior Don Baker. This first one about 3.5 minutes into the period. The second, less than a minute later, came from the stick of senior winger Bucky Holton. And less than 4 minutes after that, center Jeff Parker scored his second of two goals after opening the game scoring. And finally, Baker scored his second of the second period, and there was no catching them after that. It's been a long wait for Marin. Coach Tom Simpson is glad that wait is finally over.
Yes, it is, but basically, there are a lot of the same kids back from the team that lost in the finals, and we have a lot of seniors just like North did, and really a super job. Really pleased for them.
They seem so much more seasoned and so much more disciplined. They're really a good unit.
Well, it's another year of playing 20-some games, and that's the main difference right there. And these kids have really worked hard for it, and they made it.
Although Mariner is a first-time team in the tournament, they won't be alone in that regard. Their first-round opponent, Cloquet, is also a first-timer, and they earned their trip to St. Paul at Duluth. And Rob Lear was there.
The Section 2 title game was prematurely billed as what could have been a first for Cloquet was inevitably going to be before day's end for Coon Rapids. Corey Millen, Cloquet's ticket to the tournament, was wearing a cast, not his skates on game day, and this absence from the lineup was supposed to lead to the demise of the Lumberjacks. The only problem is someone forgot to get the message to Millen's teammates. Coon Rapids scored first. Ernie Vargas left unattended in front of the Cloquet goal. But from then on, that's the only mistake the clever Lumberjacks would make. Clever because their goals were scored at a time Coon Rapids might have thought they were doing their job. Witness Pat Messonnier's scoring play. Or Marty Catola's power play goal from the point. Cloquet, even without Millen, was playing like a team possessed and beat Coon Rapids 4-2. For Cloquet coach Bill Kennedy, this unexpected victory was a dream come true.
Super darling small school business, and I think everyone, you know, you've got good enough teams to get there, but something always happens, you know, that Cinderella garbage, and we kind of put it to our kids that, you know, you're just not tough enough. If you want to get there, you got to be a tad mean.
Once upon a time, Notre Dame 1-1 for the Gipper. In 1982, Cloquet 1-1 for their captain, Corey Millen, a victory that community will never forget. From the Section 2 hockey finals in Duluth, let's go back to the Civic Center in St. Paul and Bob Bruce.
There you have it, the opening day lineup of this 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament. We've got Rochester Mayo and Edina. Those two teams will be taking the ice in just a few moments. Then we've got defending champion Bloomington Jefferson against East Grand Forks. Tonight, of course, it's Henry Sibley meeting Hibbing, a very tough team, and Cloquet. What a story they've been, taking on fellow newcomer White Bear Mariner. Now, we've got much more for you from the St. Paul Civic Center, and we'll have it for you in just a moment.
Government. It's impersonal, imperfect, and always expensive. Yet your government is constantly affecting your life and forever spending your money. That's why at Eyewitness News, you've got government specialist Marcia Fleur covering this crucial part of your life for you. Marcia Fleur brings government into focus, keeping you informed on where your tax dollar is going and how your money is spent. Government specialist Marcia Fleur on Eyewitness News, the news leader with new ideas on Channel 5.
Of all of the items America gets from a foreign country, this is one of the most precious. Nearly 70% of North America's wild ducks are born in Canada. But those nesting areas are becoming depleted. If they disappear, so will our ducks. Ducks Unlimited is working hard to preserve the prime nesting grounds for our duck population. Join Ducks Unlimited, because if ducks have no home, America will have no ducks.
Hello, I'm here with a couple of friends to tell you about a basketball game between the Minnesota Vikings and the St. Paul Police Department. The game is at St. Thomas College on Summit and Creighton on Saturday, April 3rd. Game time is 7 p.m. Tickets are $3.50, with all proceeds going to the Lafayette Youth Club. For ticket reservations, call 333-5577. Tickets will also be available at the door of St. Thomas College on the night of the game, through local businesses and the Lafayette Youth Club.
Hi. I'm Bobby Smith of the Minnesota North Stars. Did you know that each year more Americans die from heart disease, stroke, and related disorders than all other causes of death combined? The American Heart Association, Minnesota affiliate, is working to control America's number one killer. Your generous support will fund research efforts, public and professional education, and community service programs. The Minnesota Heart Association. We're fighting for your life.
We're back live at the St. Paul Civic Center. The stands are beginning to fill up, and Edina, a heavy favorite in this tournament, has just taken the ice. Rochester Mayo will be out in just moments for the start of today's action. You know, this is the toughest ticket in town. There's no doubt about that. That's why we're especially pleased to be bringing you all the exciting championship action of the Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament right here on Channel 5. Broadcasting the tournament, definitely one of the most challenging things we do, and it also happens to be one of the most rewarding.
Televising the state hockey tournament isn't a simple operation. In fact, it takes a week just to set up the equipment that's needed to do the broadcast. For instance, we install nearly 2 miles of cable each time we do the tournament. That cable interconnects 11 color television cameras, which cover the 9 games we broadcast between this afternoon's opening session and the final game Saturday night. Those 11 cameras are only part of the story. Even though we do cover the tournament from ice level to about as high above it as you can get, those cameras also serve to provide replays of the action. And to be sure you don't miss anything, we've added a third slow motion machine this year. Along with the cameras and tape machines come all of the technical gear necessary to use what those cameras are shooting, what replays are being recorded, and what tournament sounds and voices are being heard. And of course, all of this takes people. From Tom Hamper and Steve Hammergan, who produce and direct the game action from our remote bus, a control room on wheels, to Randy Trillinger, who's logging slow-mos. Ben Vogel, Tom Olson, and Greg Johnson, who see that those slow-mos get on the air. To Kathy Kramer, who does special project directing. To Chief Engineer George Merrill and Production Chief John Deegan, who pace around and worry a lot. But they really don't have to. Not when the coverage of this tournament is in the capable hands of such people as Maureen, Al, Tom, Kevin, and Denny. And that's just a few of the 50 folks needed every minute, every game for 3 days, bringing you the Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament.
a clerical error, a young man.
Well, as you probably have gathered, you can have all the miles of cable you want and all the television cameras you want to put into this building, but it takes people to put on a great broadcast. Now, you've seen some of the ones that you normally will not see during our telecast. Now we'd like to introduce you to some of the people that you will see during our three-day broadcast of this high school tournament. One of those that you'll be seeing throughout the 3 days, a very, very familiar face as a player, as a coach, as a general manager, as a former color commentator on broadcast of this tournament. We probably remember him most for inspiring the chant, Lou, Lou, when he played for the Minnesota North Stars, a classic pose there. Louie played for the University of Minnesota, the U.S. Olympic team in 68, and is now general manager of the Minnesota North Stars, which under his leadership got to its first Stanley Cup final last season, and of course last night tied the New York Islanders 4-4. Louie, you've been here before. You know about the excitement of this tournament.
Well, it's a tremendous tournament, Bob. It's a great thrill for the players to participate, and I know the fans have always had a great time watching it.
And you always have some surprises that first day.
Well, anytime you've got a one-game tournament, you never know what's going to happen. Look at the Olympics. Look at so many championships in the past in this tournament that have been decided. That's what makes it so interesting.
Some, I know you're going to be interested in a lot of the players, not only from the standpoint of the broadcast, but also for future consideration, shall we say.
Well, this is a nice way to scout. There's probably 40 scouts here from teams all over the NHL, but I think I've got the best view from up here, and I can also watch the slow-mo replays.
Louie's going to be with us between periods and all through the games for expert analysis, of course. Well, it's great to have Lou on board for this year as our color commentary, as he has since we began these broadcasts. We have another old friend. Of course, most of you know him as the play-by-play voice of the Minnesota North Stars. He's without a doubt the best hockey broadcaster in the country. And Al Shaver, we're going to do it again. Here we go.
Well, it's going to be a lot of fun, Bobby. It's three wild days, and I think we're going to see a great tournament this year, again, as we always have.
Well, and as I say, we'll probably have some surprises. Now, let's go to the rest of the members of our broadcast crew. First, let's go downstairs rinkside to Bob Utek.
Well, here we are back for our 25th straight high school hockey tournament at the St. Paul Civic Center, and what fun it's going to be. We're going to be interviewing a lot of people, including Mark Pavlich's sister, Carol, who just returned from a New York visit, and she'll be on between the two games. And then we're going to talk with Don Roberts later on today and find all the things out about the upcoming college East-West All-Star game, which happens on March the 29th. We're not going to pick any favorites today. We'll tell you that Jefferson High School is a block from our house, so you take it from there. All right, let's throw it over to Ed Cairo now, and we'll keep on rolling.
All right, Bob, and we're down here in our what we like to call our basement interview area. Actually, it's down by the dressing rooms, where we'll be talking to winning coaches after each period, along with players who played an important part in winning these games all the way along the line until Saturday night in the championship. And we'll also be talking to a lot of other people about innovations and equipment, about what the Coaches Association is saying this year about two-class tournaments and the like. And, of course, we've got another broadcast partner who's all over this place, really. Sometimes he's out in the seats. Sometimes he's down in the sub-basement. Sometimes he's up on the roof. Do you know where he is, Joe? We're supposed to introduce Rob Lear. We understood that maybe he'd be over by the concession.
Bird's eye view of the St. Paul Civic Center with Roger Greenan, the pilot in control of SkyCam's helicopter this afternoon, as our custom will continue this year at the hockey tournament. Our mobile camera will allow us not only to roam inside the arena, but outside as well, and talk to those that make up the color and pageantry of this great hockey spectacle. So, Bob, from 500 feet high above the arena, we can tell you that traffic is moving quite well in anticipation of this great event. So, from SkyCam's helicopter, let's go back to Bob Bruce in the broadcast booth.
Thank you, Rob. We're all ready. Edina versus Rochester Mayo, and we'll be back with the action of the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament right after station identification.
Hi, I'm Jim Peck.
And I'm Pam Ward. Join us on our next Twin Cities Today and meet two of the stars from the hit TV series, Happy Days.
Dr. William Nolan will be here to tell us why no medicine is completely safe.
And we'll explore a 20-room mansion occupied by University of Minnesota President C. Peter McGraw and his wife, Diane. So join us at 9 a.m. right here on Channel 5.
With all the news that's happening around the state and the world, you need time to listen to details, hear arguments, and decide for yourself how that news affects you. Eyewitness News at 5 gives you that chance with in-depth looks at specific issues, like who's responsible for cleaning up hazardous waste sites, how can you cut your taxes, and why the rage over designer clothes for kids. Eyewitness News at 5 gives you extra insight into news you need to know. Eyewitness News at 5, from the news leader with new ideas on Channel 5.
Hi, I'm Bobby Smith of the Minnesota North Stars. Did you know that each year more Americans die from heart disease, stroke, and related disorders than all other causes of death combined? The American Heart Association, Minnesota affiliate, is working to control America's number one killer. Your generous support will fund research efforts, public and professional education, and community service programs. The Minnesota Heart Association. We're fighting for your life.
KSTP-TV, St. Paul, Minneapolis.
Live from the St. Paul Civic Center Arena, it's the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament. Now for the start of today's tournament action, here's Channel 5 Sports Director Bob Bruce.
Hello again, everyone. I'm Bob Bruce, and good afternoon. We're ready for the first of four exciting games of this, the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament. Working with me up here in the booth, of course, Lou Nanny, general manager of the Minnesota North Stars, our expert color commentator, and, of course, with the play-by-play, the voice of the Minnesota North Stars, Al Shaver. Both teams are on the ice, and we're just about ready for the starting lineups. We're just a few moments away from the opening game, Rochester Mayo against Edina. Both teams are on the ice, warming up, and the lineups are just a few moments away. And Al and Lou, as always, no doubt about it, excitement galore as these teams, for a lot of these athletes, this will be the culmination of their hockey playing days.
It certainly will be, Bob. And as you know, Rochester Mayo coming here for their first appearance, they're very excited. In the past, they've always lost out to a team in their division, and Rochester Marshall had been here before and had won a championship. But this is the first time for this school, and it's a great thrill for all the people down in Rochester. For Edina, this is the first time they've combined schools and gotten back. They had four losses during the season, but they are as highly rated as any team in the state, and they know that one game can put them out. So it should be an exciting contest. Edina is favored, but Rochester Mayo surprised some people this season. They started off slow and came on strong. It should be very exciting.
I know, Al, you saw a lot of the sectional finals. Do you have a favorite in this tournament?
I'm rooting for East Grand Forks because they're the only team that nobody has given a chance to. I think, to be honest with you, though, I think we'll see a final on Saturday night of Edina and Hibbing.
Well, that seems to be the two heavy favorites, but in the several years that we've been doing this tournament, we always have a couple upsets that first day, and who knows, we could see one here in the first game between Rochester Mayo and Edina. These two teams have played before. And Edina, I believe, Al, won that game earlier in the year by a score of 6-2.
That is correct. 6-2, Edina winning.
Total sellout, of course, as always. Just about no way in the world you can get a ticket for this. And we'll be back in just a moment with the start of today's game. This is the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament.
In places like Goodhue County in the middle of winter, you learn what built Ford tough really means.
I walk into my garage and my Ford is sitting out there in the cold, and it starts every day.
This pickup is tough. I really love it. That's what I call my going machine. It's the pride and joy of the farm. I value this thing more than any piece of farm equipment I have.
Tough Ford trucks. See them now at your nearby Northland Ford dealer.
There's a hungry beast feeding in your house. It's your old furnace, and its appetite is costing you more and more every day. Your Lennox dealer can tame your heating costs with a new Lennox Conservator gas furnace, the most efficient gas furnace yet.
This is Dave Lennox recommending a call to Russ Gregg at Midland Heating, serving Minneapolis and South Suburbs. Or call Don Bell for energy-efficient Lennox equipment from Fred Boat Company.
Join Christian Brothers' Great Stick Shift. Shift to the only aluminum stick approved for play by the NHL. Christian's revolutionary aluminum shaft hockey stick is lighter than wood, and that means this stick is quick. Every aluminum shaft has the exact same weight and flex. That's consistency. Pro hockey players say it's true. They stick handle better, pass better, shoot quicker, harder, and with more accuracy with Christian Brothers' aluminum stick. Join the shift to the Christian Brothers aluminum hockey stick.
I'm here in the locker room with Bob Carter. Bob, those goalies are making some tremendous saves out there.
They sure are, just like the saves our customers are making at the big tournament sale at Bob Carter Ford, AMC Jeep, and Renault.
Yes, but what about the slashing?
We've slashed our prices way, way down. 82 Fairmonts as low as $63.30, a new 81 Mustang just $52.21.
But, Bob, who do you think will win?
Everyone who comes to Bob Carter Ford, AMC Jeep, and Renault. We're just 5 minutes east of the Mendota Bridge on 110 or South Robert to 110.
Thanks, Bob. Now back to Al in the booth.
We're back live at the St. Paul Civic Center, gearing up for that first game, first of four games, of course, this afternoon. And now we're ready for the starting lineups of today's first game between Rochester Mayo and, of course, Edina. First for the Edina Hornets, number one, Jim Lisinski, goalie, 6'1", 165 pounds. He's a senior. Then number two on defense, Tom Rizzut, 5'10", 165 pounds. This is a big Edina team. Watch this fellow today. Boy, he was great in the sectional final. Number three, Wally Chapman at center, 6 feet, 185 pounds. Back on defense, number four, Mike Roberts, 190 pounds, 6'2". As I said, they are big. Andy Cassett, number five on defense, 6 feet, 185 pounds. He's a senior. Mike McCarthy, he scored in the sectional final against Wayzata. A center, 5'10", 160 pounds, a senior. Jay Malmquist on the wing, number seven, 5'11", 160 pounds. He's a senior. Paul Roth, number 10, a winger, 5'11", 165. He is a junior. A senior. Jeff Vacati, number 11, a winger, 5'10", 175. Here's a big defenseman here. Bill Brower, number 12, 6'3", 200 pounds. He's a senior and a big one. Number 14, Greg McCush, a center, 5'11", 170 pounds. He's a junior. A lot of seniors and juniors on this team, an experienced team. Brian Cutshaw, number 16, a winger, 6 feet, 180, a senior. Also a senior, Dave Baker, number 17, on defense, 6'1", 170 pounds. Number 18, John DeVoe on the wing, 6'2", 175. He is a senior. And Dave Maley. What a game he had against Wayzata in the sectional final. Number 19, 6'2", 195 pounds, a big one, a senior. Dan Carroll, number 20, a wing, 5'10", 165 pounds. He's a junior. Also a junior, Mike DeVoe. He is number 21. And the other goalie, and Edina alternates their goalies every other game, number 30, Kevin Galbraith, 5'10", 195 pounds. He is, of course, a senior. And, of course, the head coach of Edina, Willard Eichela, the assistant coach, Bart Larson. You remember Bart Larson is the head coach of last year's Edina entrant, Edina West. That's the Section 6 champions. Now let's go to Section 1, Rochester Mayo. They all have a tough task playing against this Edina team today. Number one, John McCauley. He's a goalie, 5'10", 165 pounds, a senior. Dan Lohr, number three on the wing, 5'7", 192 pounds. He's a senior. A junior on defense, Bill Jennison, number four, 5'10", 196 pounds. Also a junior on defense, Brad Glenn, number five, 5'11", 155 pounds. A senior, Jeff Lamb, number seven, a center, 5'9", 155 pounds. A junior, 165 pounds, 5'10", on defense, Hugh Smith, number eight. Then Jim Grosso, number nine, on the wing, a 5'8", 145 pounds, a sophomore, Grosso. Number 10, Pete Williams, a winger, 5'10", 168 pounds, a senior. Here's a familiar name to many Bloomington Jefferson fans, Scott Soderdalen, a winger, 5'9", 155 pounds, a junior. A senior, winger, 5'11", 175, Chris Beck, number 12. Number 14, a defender, DiMaggio, Ted DeMagno, rather, 6'1", 175 pounds, a senior. Kurt Whitney on defense, 5'9", 167 pounds, a senior, number 15. Number 16, John Seaver, a center, 6'3", 185 pounds. He is a senior, also a senior at 160 pounds, 5'10". Pete Stauffer at center, number 17. Number 18, Marty Gaslin. 5'8", 155 pounds, a goalie, a senior, and a sophomore, Doug Wick. He's a good player, too. Number 20, 5'10", 157 pounds. Senior Brad Johnson, number 21, 165 pounds, a senior. And Jim Johansson, senior center, 6'1", 172 pounds, and he is number 30. Lauren Grosso is the head coach. Jim Volker, the assistant coach. And they have an enrollment of 1,494. That's Rochester Mayo out of Section 1.
We ask you to stand and join in singing as the Rochester Mayo High School Band, under the direction of John Green, leads us in the Star-Spangled Banner.
National anthem played for us by the Rochester Mayo Band, the Spartan Band. Here we have a look at the referees for today, Terry Abram and William Hocking. Edina versus Rochester Mayo, a matchup of two teams, a very physical, very experienced Edina team against Rochester Mayo. And as I said earlier, these two teams have met before. Here you have the goalies. Jim Lozinski will start in goal for Edina, and John McCauley will be in goal for Rochester Mayo. Both teams huddle around their respective nets for that last bit of emotional uplift, I guess. And we're just about ready to go, Lou.
Well, Rochester Mayo's got a fine hockey player in Jim Johansson. His brother, as a matter of fact, John Johansson, was their star 2 years ago. He's playing in Wisconsin. He's the one the Edina defense people will be keen on. Edina, of course, got a little more balance up front. Their center, Dave Maley, a very good playmaker. Great speed in DeVoe. John DeVoe's got excellent speed in the right side. And the fellow to watch goal scoring is Wally Chapman. Bill Brower, by the way, defenseman and co-captain for this Edina team. A big, strong, good-looking prospect. He's a fellow that's given them a lot of strength back in that back line and protected these goaltenders quite a bit. It is ironic, as you said earlier, Bob, that Edina has two goaltenders and they're not afraid to alternate each of them, and they do that quite often.
Well, we're ready for that time again where the most exciting voice in hockey brings you the play-by-play of the first game of the 82 tournament. They're ready to drop the puck, and that means we turn it all over to none other than Al Shaver.
Louis's got family ties in this one, you know. This Grosso kid for Rochester is what, your cousin?
That's right. I got my cousin on one side and I live on the other side.
Okay. The puck shot into the Edina zone to the right of the goaltender. Coming back of the net, Cassett is tied up. The puck dug loose by Mayo. Played to the near boards. Relayed to the blue line. Here's Glenn setting up. His shot hit traffic. Goes wide to the right. And now it's fed to DeVoe on the right side. John DeVoe overskating, but the follow-up man clears it as it's driven off the boards by Cassett. Now the puck at center. Maley at the Rochester blue line is dumped on the play by Smith, and the puck is cleared down the ice by the Spartans of Rochester Mayo. Back of the goal, Cassett is checked there on the play, and Johansson takes over the puck, tried to put it in front, knocked in behind by Lozinski, and now picked up on the left wing side by Kutchell. Long pass to center, too far for Maley. Comes back deep in the Rochester zone.
cleared around on the left wing side by McCauley, held in by DeVoe, and now Glynn banks it out off the near board. Driven back in by Rizzut, who's on now. Rizzut and Baker on defense for Edina as the teams have made their first changes in the game. The puck back of the goal, and an attempt to center it out is broken up as Carroll is tied up behind the net by Glynn. The puck is frozen for a stoppage and a faceoff in the Rochester zone.
Both teams forechecking very aggressively. Rochester, as a matter of fact, had three men in deep that time trying to get the Edina defenseman to cough up the puck, and they almost had a real fine chance.
Face-off to the right of McCauley. Here's a shot right on from the face-off by Carroll. Carroll chasing the puck to the corner, puts it out in front in the circle. Now it comes back to the blue line. Rizzuta's shot. He's wide on the left side. And in the corner now, Jennison is jammed to the boards. Puck still in the corner. DeVoe battling for it. This is the other DeVoe, Mike, for Edina, number 21. The puck still in the Rochester zone, but it's brought out now on the far side. Here's Grosso. In over the line, a rink-wide pass comes to the right of the Edina goal, and a centering attempt by Jennison is broken up and is picked up behind the net now by Rizzut. Fed out on the left side. Here's Carroll at center, driving it in, rink-wide to the left. Now Rizzut's shot is blocked in the left circle as it hit the skate of a defenseman, Jennison. The puck at the blue line, dumped back in by Mike DeVoe, who pursues it. He runs into DeMagno, the puck in the left corner, a centering pass by McCarthy. And it goes rink wide to the right wing boards. It's fed out to center by Lamb, and it's picked off by the Hornets at center. No score as Edina attacks. Played in over the blue line now. Left circle, a centering attempt is picked up in the slot by the Rochester Spartans, and back they come on the attack with Beck. Over the blue line, right up the slot, Beck a shot! Oh, and the first really big save of the hockey game is made by Jim Lozinski as he's knocked back into the net when Beck collided with him. And we'll have a face-off in the Edina zone when they put the net back on its anchoring post.
And Beck did make a heck of a play. As you see him splitting the defense, coming right down. Lozinski comes out to challenge him. From our overhead camera, you can see Lozinski up at the top of the crease to cut down the angle and just follow that puck in. It's a fine play by Lozinski, covering up and not allowing any rebound there as the net and everything else was moved right out of the way.
What an overhead shot that one is. Face off to Lozinski's right. From the draw, the Spartans get possession, and a backhand shot by Stauffer goes to the left corner. Now Seaver is after it in the corner, but he's surrounded by Hornets, and they come out buzzing at center ice. Vacanti firing it into the left corner. It slides in behind the net. Glynn there clearing it to the right side for Rochester. At the point, Brower holds it in. This is Vacanti now in the right circle. A shot right on. The save made by McCauley, and he drops on the rebound.
One thing we'll notice a lot of, Al, goaltenders in all minor hockey, minor pro hockey, they really don't have an opportunity to develop handling the puck as much, so you see a lot of stoppages in play.
There's a break in the action with the score. Edina nothing, Rochester nothing.
Klassen's Athletic and Repair specializes in reconditioning all hockey equipment. If you're in charge of athletic equipment, call Klassen's for further information. Klassen's in Forest Lake.
Johansson centering for Rochester on the far side. Johnson puts it back in front. It's picked off, and a long clearing shot at center by Rizzut goes all the way down the ice. Maley after it, but it's cleared around to the left side by the goaltender McCauley. Puck still in the Rochester zone. Johansson in the left corner, checked by Maley. Now given a bump by DeVoe, but he feeds up the left side. Wick comes to center and drives it in. Lozinski controlling at the right side of the goal and now elects to cover it with Brad Johnson right in the neighborhood and ready to do some business had the puck come loose.
That's what we were talking about. The goaltenders should learn to handle the puck a little bit more, leave it in a position where their defenseman, without breaking stride, can get it and get it out, because you want to cut down on the number of faceoffs in your own zone, since you give the opposition a chance to score by doing that.
This will be Wally Chapman. No, wait a minute. Maley on the faceoff against Jim Grosso. Puck shot around behind to the left corner. Baker puts it back in the net. Lamb picks it off, goes to the right side, tried to work it in front. Here's a pass up the slot. Comes back to the blue line. A backhander hits a skate on that drive by Smith. It winds up behind the net. Lamb coming to the left side. He is checked by Maley, who clears the left. Cutshell fails to get out. Baker back in the corner. He's tied up. Now others pile in along the boards. The puck comes loose for Cutshell.
Cutshell on the left side, trying to come out for the Hornets. A long pass, too far for John DeVoe, and it's all the way down the ice for icing. There's a break in the action with the score. Rochester nothing, Edina nothing.
The Minnesota State Hockey Tournament is brought to you by your nearby Northland Ford dealer, who invites the class of 82 to stop by and test drive the sporty new EXP.
Face off to the left of Lozinski. The puck comes in front of the net, and it's cleared on the right side to Mike DeVoe. A relay now. Here is Chapman moving in. Left side. Tied up by DeMagno. Puts it in front, and a deflection just goes wide to the left. As Carroll was there in front for Edina, and we're going to have a stoppage as the Rochester goal has become unanchored on the right side. And we'll have a face-off outside the Spartans' blue line to resume play. 10:40 left in a scoreless first period.
By the way, number nine for Rochester Mayo, Jimmy Grosso, is the coach's son, Lauren Grosso. He's a sophomore this season. Played a lot like a dad, his dad, handling that puck.
Now Brower with the puck at center for the Hornets, driving it in, set up behind by McCauley, cleared to the right by DeMagno, a relay on the right side, trying to get loose from traffic, a stopper, it's put out in front, and a sprawling save by McCauley on a chance from the right side by Chapman. It's back out at center ice, and it's shot right back in by Edina defenseman Andy Cassid. Back of the goal, DeMagno comes out to McCauley's right, head manning to Beckett center now. He's going to his off wing, passing off on the play. The puck deflects into the Edina zone, and Brower clears. DeMagno back covering in the Rochester zone and banking out to center off the near boards. Now it's fired right back in by Cassid, and the Spartans clear. Back into the Rochester zone from behind the net. Baker, head manning on the left side. A relay pass for McCarthy. It's blocked, but Baker carries on. Into the Rochester zone. Baker, right circle, backhand shot, steered behind by McCauley. Baker in pursuit, comes to the near boards, back to Rizzut at the point. Rizzut is bumped. The puck still in the zone, however. Centered by Roth, and McCarthy got turned around, losing the puck. Rizzut puts it out in front. Loose puck deep in the slot, fed back to the point. Baker shot, and that goes wide to the right off Johnson's skate. Now it's frozen to the boards, and we'll have another face-off coming up in the Rochester zone with 9:22 left in a scoreless first period. There's a break in the action. The score, 9-0, Rochester nothing.
Stone Wings offers those little personal touches that only private ownership can bring. Valet parking, reservations, and even a sit-down Sunday brunch. Stone Wings, Bloomington.
Minor penalty on the Spartans number four,
We have a first penalty of the hockey game being taken by defenseman Bill Jennison. At 5:38, Bill Jennison of Rochester for charging. So Edina on the power play here, and the puck is cleared out of the Rochester zone, the length of the ice. Skating it down is Rizzut, who comes back of Lozinski, makes a traffic check, slides the puck to the left now, and the Hornets attack with the man advantage. Here they come in over the line with Maley working toward the slot. Poke checked off his stick neatly by Glenn. Cutshell comes back of the net to the left corner now. Plays it back for DeVoe. Chapman, and a return pass is tied up in the corner by Glenn. We'll have a faceoff in the Rochester zone to the left.
Rochester defense giving Maley a little too much time to carry that puck in instead of challenging him.
From the faceoff, a shot grazing the left side of the goal. And Mayo picking it up, and it's cleared out to center. Poked back in offside, but Rochester able to clear, so they waive the delayed offside call. And now Maley with the puck in the Edina zone, putting it out on the left side. It deflects off to DeVoe's skate. Glenn in the Rochester zone clears the line and out, apparently. And it's brought back in offside. They whistle it for a faceoff outside the Rochester blue line. There's a break in the action. The score, Rochester nothing, Edina nothing.
Win a one-week vacation for two anywhere under the sun. Tell us where in the world you'd like to go. Listen to KS95 FM.
A minute, 8 seconds left in the penalty time on Jennison. Now here's a shot right on by Carroll. And the save made by McCauley at the front edge of the crease, and he goes to his knees to smother.
Well, Carroll, a left-hand shot breaking around the defenseman, was in good position. He had a good angle, but a fine save by McCauley coming out and smothering that puck.
Face off to McCauley's left. McCauley has been the busier of the netminders thus far. Edina still on the power play as the puck is cleared. Rink wide off the boards and down the ice. Brower coming back as Lozinski clears it to his left. Rochester picking it up, but it's broken up along the boards and brought back at the net now as the Hornets try to come out. McCarthy overskated, reached back to put it out to center for Carroll. He's trapped, tapped it back into his zone, and back of the net with it comes Cassid. Makes a quick traffic check. Headbands on the right side for Carroll now. Rink wide pass to the left. Brower has to stop to get control. Feeds it into the neutral zone. It's picked off and it's shot back into the Edina zone by DeMagno. 24 seconds left in the penalty now. Pass on the right to Carroll. In over the Rochester line. The puck poke checked off his stick, but it's given back to him in the left corner. To the right point, Cassid. Cassid working it around now, feeding it ahead for McCarthy. It goes by him. Now McCarthy takes a drop from Carroll, comes in front, a shot, and just wide to the left. And the puck is cleared. A high backhand clearing shot as the penalty expires on Jennison. And the Rochester Spartans back at full strength. Icing has been called against them.
Two good saves by goalie McCauley right there was McCarthy. He came in. He looked like he had some of the short side, but a good save kept the score at nothing, and a fine penalty kill by Rochester Mayo. Something you want to do early is make sure that you kill your penalties off so that you don't give the other team some momentum.
From the faceoff between Maley and Johansson, the puck goes to the right wing boards. Johnson failed to get out against Kutchell. It's cleared around behind to Hugh Smith on the left side. He headmans to the blue line. Johansson ran into a check and lost the puck as he was taken out of the play by Rizzut. Back in comes Maley, but we have an offside call.
This Rochester Mayo club playing with a great deal of poise right now. Edina heavily favored coming into this game, has had their hands full. Mayo killed off a penalty and has had some good chances of their own before that.
Puck at center, Rizzut firing it in for Edina. Picked up by Maley, left circle in front. DeVoe, he scores! DeVoe with the tournament's first goal. John DeVoe backhanding it in on a pass from Dave Maley. And it's 1-0. The goal coming at the 8:08 mark of the first period. The Edina Hornets lead it.
And what a pass that was from Maley, Al. We'll see it again on the replay. He set him up just beautiful. Look for Maley, he comes up with a puck. Slides it right back, little backhand, and there's the shot by DeVoe.
Well, John DeVoe made a good move as he saw the goaltender come out to cut the angle down. DeVoe took that pass, he cut to the front. He had some time. He made a little move and went to his backhand to beat him. The key in that play, the puck just seemed to flip into the zone, and DeMagno went to touch it, and it just dropped down and went right to Maley. Maley making that pass over, and the goal by DeVoe.
We're back live. The play is in the Rochester zone on the right side. Trying to come out was Williams. The puck comes to center, but the Hornets come right back in. Now broken up nicely. Jennison taking the man out along the wall. A long shot from the right point by Cassid. Picked off in the slot, and back comes Jennison now. Backhanding it into the Edina zone to the left. In the corner with it is Brower. He's checked. A centering attempt played back of the net. Now a shot from the right side by Jennison, and he put it in the netting. Telozinski's right. The puck behind the net, and we've got an Edina man down and covering. And we'll have a stoppage and a face-off in the Edina zone. And there's a break in the action. The score is Edina 1, Rochester nothing.
Motorcraft 10W40 Super Premium Motor Oil, now just 69 cents with 5-quart purchase and Motorcraft rebate at all Kmart stores. Motorcraft oil, just 69 cents at Kmart.
Face off to the right of Jim Lozinski, and here's a chance for Lamb, a shot, and Lozinski sticks that away to the left side. Carroll in the corner now, fanned on it, and then a shot around behind on a second effort, and on the right side, Mike DeVoe headmanning to center, Chapman relaying to his left. It's broken up just inside the Rochester blue line by Smith, and we have an offside call against Edina, and they'll take a face off. It's not offside, pardon me. Yeah, it was an illegal advance of the puck, a hand pass, I believe. From the faceoff just inside the blue line, it's held in by Edina. A long shot by Rizzut deflects off a stick and out of play, and we'll have another faceoff at the point where the puck was fired, about 10 feet inside the Rochester blue line.
That's something you don't see much of. We've got the real high glass here in this auditorium, and that keeps the puck in play. And it's something that many arenas are going to.
This is Hugh Smith pursuing in the right corner, clearing off the boards to center ice. Baker sliding it to Rizzut now. Headman's on the right. It deflects off Roth and comes in the Rochester zone where it's cleared by Glenn to center. And the Spartans try to get something going, but Seaver checked out at the blue line. Now Beck puts it in front. It's picked up by Vacanti in the left circle. A bank off the boards, deep into the zone, is chased by Roth, but Glenn will be there at the same time. They tie up. Glenn gets possession, clears to the line, held in by Baker. Glenn picks off his pass, comes to center, and his shot is batted down at the Edina blue line by Rizzut, who plays it back in the Rochester zone. Glenn rink-widing to the left now for Smith. A high pass batted down at center ice, and down on the play goes the man who had possession, Stauffer. Edina coming back in, but it's cleared by DeMagno and then back into the zone offside.
Edina's size up front enables them to knock Rochester players off the puck a little more consistently than Rochester can do to them. Consequently, they're getting that puck in the neutral zone and just controlling a lot more than Rochester is at this time.
Face-off Mealy against Johansson. The puck back in the Rochester zone is cleared to center. In comes Wick, slides it to his left. Along the near boards, Johnson back to the blue line. DeMagno couldn't see the net, puts it in the left corner. Johansson is jammed there by Brower. The puck around behind to the near side. A shot right in there. DeMagno firing from the left point, moving in just outside the circle to Lozinski's right, and he put it in to tie it at 10:29.
Let's look at it again as Rochester Mayo comes back to tie this game. Look for Johansson at the corner of the net. First the shot, and let's see if we get a good look at it. Right there.
A good shot by DeMagno, but just previous to that, it was a real fine slap shot that hit the pipe and gave Rochester that chance. That puck came all the way around off the slap shot, and there's DeMagno's shot. Lozinski losing sight of it. The puck ending up in the net, I think.
Did Johansson tip that at all?
I don't think so. I think he might have gone right in with DeMagno. He might have got a stick on it, but it looked like DeMagno might have put it right in.
It was. Apparently, Johansson did tip it right at the goal mouth. So he gets the goal, DeMagno the assist. Here's Mealy coming in. A centering pass broken up in front of the Rochester goal and cleared to the line. A nice defensive play by Johnson. Edina holding it in, but now it's cleared to Johnson at center. Brad Johnson shooting it in rink-wide to the left of the goal. Brower has it for Edina. Headman short, relay to center ice now. Right wing pass, DeVoe pursuing it in the Rochester zone. It's cleared past him. Now Chapman after it, but the puck slides back over the blue line and out to center ice. And here comes Lamb over the line. He's got a man with him. A centering pass, a shot, they score! Johnson on a pass from Lamb. And Mayo goes in front, 2-1. 9:27, the time of the goal. Make that 11:27.
Well, you don't ever let Edina get momentum. They may have scored the first goal, but right now, Rochester Mayo playing great hockey. Look at that beautiful pass. Nice shot, and they lead it 2-1.
Johnson from Lamb and Glenn. 2-1 Rochester. The puck back in the Edina zone. This is Baker clearing to the left. Carroll head manning, and here come the Hornets in now. Chapman tied up, gets free, put it in front. DeVoe tried to relay it back to Chapman, but it's broken up. And Mayo in possession in their own zone now. Rick wide pass on the right at the blue line. Williams in over the line to Lamb. Lamb runs into a check from Rizzut. The puck is still in the zone. Lamb deep in the slot, but it's knocked off his stick and out to center. Now here come the Hornets with Carroll losing it at the blue line as he's checked by DeMagno. The puck deflecting up, and Magno traps it in his body. We'll have a face-off just inside the Rochester blue line with 2:56 remaining in the period.
There's Brad Johnson, the fellow that just put Rochester Mayo ahead 2-1 after a fine feed from Lamb. A real good pass play with Lamb pulling the defenseman over and letting Johnson go in all alone to put Rochester Mayo ahead.
From the face-off, the puck brought in by Baker. Dumps it into the right corner. DeMagno coming back of his goal for Rochester. His pass off a stick comes to the left side for Beck. In the corner, he's check centering pass. A quick shot by Vacanti. Just missed on the right. Now McCarthy on the far side, leaving it for Vacanti. Tried to center, it hits a skate, and out come the Spartans of Rochester. Pass to the right side is relayed into the Edina zone.
And now a drive from the far boards goes up high, rink wide, moving in off the point is Jennison. He lost the puck, and it's cleared on out to center ice now by Roth. A battle for it in the neutral zone along the near boards. Roth playing it off the boards, picking it up and shooting it into the Rochester zone. DeMagno clearing around behind to Johnson on the right side. Brad Johnson, who had the go-ahead goal, puts it out to center ice. It's relayed on into the Edina zone by Seaver as he goes to the bench on a change. Back of the net now, McCarthy coming out to the left, banking it off the far boards. It comes out to center, and Hugh Smith guns it back in. And this time it goes out of play. 1:48 remaining in the first period. It's 2-1 for Rochester Mayo.
Rochester forwards still using some quickness to get in there and forecheck, stealing that puck, and they're playing a very aggressive first period. They feel very confident out there. Many people thought that they'd just be happy to get here, but they've come out and played extremely well, and they're giving Edina all they can.
Now back come the Hornets, moving in up the slot, and a backhand shot by Brower is wide, and it's frozen to the boards. Back to the left of McCauley. We'll have a face-off in the circle to his left.
That's where they'll run into problem. Whenever they have a puck carrier coming up, and really they've got back checkers, the Rochester defensemen, if they sag a little bit, they're going to give Edina the zone and end up in some trouble. If they stand up there, they're going to cut down the chances Edina will get.
Play underway. Melee behind the Rochester goal, comes to the right, trying to put it in front. Block, back in behind again. Melee is jammed to the boards, and the puck is frozen. And we'll have another face-off in the Rochester zone.
All five Rochester players back there helping out. It's opening up the points for Edina, but Edina forwards aren't able to control the puck because the Rochester people are swarming all over them right now.
Mike must have a lifetime supply of those houndstooth hats he always wears.
Yeah, he does.
Get a deal on him somewhere. Johansson banking to center. Brad Johnson, he's got a man, Wick, on the left. Weaves to the left. Johansson coming up. A long shot by Johnson. It's blocked by Lozinski. Cleared to the left. Centered in front again. And it goes off Cassid's skate. And now coming out is DeVoe. John DeVoe bounces off one check, comes over the Rochester line, trying to get by Smith, fires a high shot wide to the goaltender's right. A shot from the point by Brower is blocked and held, and we'll have a face-off again in the Rochester zone with 54 seconds to play in the opening period.
There's goaltender John McCauley. Stood right there and took the shot in his chest and just held it as he saw DeVoe and Mealy both hovering around the net.
2-1. The Spartans lead the Hornets. Lamb facing off against Chapman. Shot right on from the faceoff. The puck cleared to the right corner. Jennison goes to his knees, and now Carroll forcing a faceoff as he ties it up along the boards to the right.
Al, I don't know if Rochester Mayo should try to push around Edina. They're so big and strong that, and that could be a factor later on in this game, that Edina may eventually wear down Rochester Mayo.
Well, Williams coming out second best in a jostle with Carroll there. Face off to the right of the goal. Williams taking the draw against Chapman. The puck goes in the right corner. Chapman feeding the point. A long shot by Baker. Came through the melee, and it's blocked by McCauley. Cleared to the right and then relayed to center ice. Picked up now by Grosso. Left a drop pass, but Carroll is driven halfway over the boards, and a good hard check right in front of the benches as he was draped over the wall. And back comes Rochester on the attack. Broken up at the blue line, Grosso falls, the puck coming out to center, and here's Carroll working on a one-on-one. Left circle and a diving save by DeMagno. Carroll centers, and it's cleared away to the left side. Now it's fed out to center ice, where it's picked up by Baker. He drives it back into the Rochester zone, but we've got a man who was down and is slow clearing the zone. We have an offside call against Mike DeVoe. 4 seconds remaining in the opening period. Rochester leading Edina by 2-1. Edina scored first, and then Rochester came back to tie and go ahead. From the faceoff, the puck is driven into the Rochester zone at the horn. And that's the end of the first period of the opening game of the 1982 State High School Hockey Tournament here at the St. Paul Civic Center.
And a good period of hockey it was with Rochester Mayo. Well, we said there'd be some surprises, and a lot of people thought that Edina would just walk through this game. That's definitely not going to be the case as Mayo takes a 2-1 lead into the locker room after the end of the first period. Now let's go down to the ice and Rob Lear.
Thank you very much, Bob. Of course, with Lauren Grasso, the head hockey coach of Rochester Mayo, and whatever you told your kids before the game, it seems to be working.
Well, I don't know. They've been fired up ever since we played Edina before, but that's only one period. We'll see what happens.
As a first-timer up against the favorite, they're really reacting very well.
Well, our kids have been really psyched about it because, you know, the first time in, they want to come up here and prove something to people, and I think they're doing a very good job.
So you're riding that emotion then?
Well, I think there's a lot of emotion, but I think I've got a lot of hockey ability, and no one's known anything about Rochester, and we've been kind of the quiet team, and maybe we'll stay that way for the next two periods, and hopefully we stay on top.
Best of luck to you.
Thank you.
Bob, let's go back upstairs.
Thanks, Rob. That's the end of the first period with a score. Rochester Mayo 2 and Edina 1.
Bobby Smith, Kemp's Ice Cream Hockey Clinic.
Every hockey player must be able to pass the puck. Dino, let's try a few. On the forehand pass, make it smooth. Don't slap it.
When receiving the pass, the puck should be cradled into the stick.
It's the same on the backhand. Handle the puck smoothly and keep your hands away from your body.
After the forehand and the backhand pass, then we switch to the fun stuff.
The Bobby Smith Kemp's Ice Cream Hockey Clinic has been brought to you by Kemp's, makers of Kemp's Ice Cream.
A month at a time, you can build a retirement fortune with the help of an IRA at TCF. You can also reduce the taxes you pay now. A retirement fortune a month at a time, even on a modest income. In 30 years, you could easily have $500,000. Maybe you think that's a long time to save. 30 years of not saving is just as long, and you end up with nothing. IRA at TCF, the sure way to build up a retirement fortune a month at a time.
Mike Bossy, Wayne Gretzky. These two champions chose Titan hockey sticks for their unique patented construction, for their feel. Titan, for their lightweight, for their durability. Titan, for their strength. Titan, no other stick scores like it.
KSDP News Time, 7:23.
If the Reagan administration has its way.
Ray Scott with sports coming up.
Our sports at this hour.
Good morning, Americans.
Good morning, this is John Farrell.
And I'm J.B. Eckert.
This is Frank Setapani at the news desk of the Wall Street Journal.
KSDP's radar, weather, and traffic coming up.
Traffic on 35.
Catch up to your world and its happenings. Wake up to news the minute you want it. All news in the morning from KSDP, News Plus Radio 1500.
Back live at the St. Paul Civic Center, Bob Bruce with Lou Nanny and Lou, and an exciting first period of hockey. Rochester Mayo surprising a lot of people. Let's go right to the highlights. It was Edina scoring first. They usually score in bunches, but this time Rochester came back to gain the momentum. Scoring at 8:08 of the first period from number 19, Maley John DeVoe. Edina led it 1-0 at that point.
Maley just pushed that puck ahead and let DeVoe cut in, and he just made a fine move on McCauley to put Edina ahead at 1-0, but not for long. But this was a fine play by DeVoe because he had to cut across. He saw the Rochester defenseman there, and he was quick enough to get the shot off after he made the move on McCauley.
Mayo came back to tie at 10:29 of the first period. Jim Johansson with a tip-in. Edina 1, Rochester 1.
Well, a shot had been taken from the right point of Rochester. It hit the pipe. Lozinski didn't even see it. It comes all the way out, and as a shot is taken there by DeMagno, Johansson cutting in front must have just got a stick on it. Lozinski didn't know where it was as he turned around, but he found it in the net.
Then number 7, Lamb to Brad Johnson at 11:27 as Mayo takes the lead 2-1.
And what a pass from Lamb. He pulled a defenseman right over to him. He saw Johnson breaking down with a little speed. Johnson had to get that shot away quick as he was being checked, but he beat Lozinski on the far side.
Both goalies playing well. Mayo, I'm sure people in Rochester aren't surprised by the performance of Mayo.
Well, maybe not the people in Rochester because they know what a good team Mayo is, but most other people thought Edina coming in heavily favored would have an easy time, but they're sure not. Two things Mayo's got to watch out for. They're giving the blue line up a little too much, allowing Edina to get in, and they're also five of them sagging back to help out the defensemen, the goaltenders, and they're leaving the points of Edina open, which could result in goals just as Rochester got from the point. Edina, on the other hand, being a little sloppy in front of their own net and giving Mayo some good chances.
Should be a great second period. Rochester leads it 2-1 over Edina. The exciting action of the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament will continue after station identification.
To keep in touch with the latest sports news, dial sports 1-976-1313. For just 20 cents a call, get the latest news, scores, stories, plus special features from me, Ray Scott. Wherever sports news is being made, in the Twin Cities or across the nation, hear it first on Dial Sports. Call 1-976-1313.
5 years ago, a team of Honda engineers set out to create the world's most advanced motorcycle, the CX-500 Turbo. A water-cooled, fuel-injected, turbocharged motorcycle systematically controlled by a digital computer. The CX-500 Turbo. The only thing about it that is not surprising is the name of the company that built it.
See the new Honda Turbo at Burnsville Sports Center and Larson Cycle.
Channel 5, KSTP-TV, St. Paul, Minneapolis.
We now return to the St. Paul Civic Center Arena and the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament.
Nice shot of the Edina High School band. They're trying to drum up the fans because right now their team is trailing by a score of 2-1 after one period of play, Rochester Mayo over Edina. All day long, we're going to be giving you some features on each individual school so that you can learn a little more about them. Now, let's find out a little something about Rochester Mayo in our first school feature.
Mayo High School, located in Rochester, Minnesota, about 80 miles south of the Twin Cities, is a unique school in a progressive town. Rochester, world-renowned for the Mayo Clinic and other medical facilities, also has a community college and a vocational program. An outstanding recreation center was constructed, giving the city modern sports facilities. IBM, the largest manufacturer of business machines, has a major computer branch here. Large crowds are drawn to watch the thousands of Canadian geese which are attracted to the warmed waters of Silver Lake. Mayo High School, constructed during 1965 and 66, offers a variety of learning experiences. Sportsman's biology, involving the science and physical education departments, includes laboratory work as well as outdoor activities. The Community Awareness Program combines classroom studies with community experiences. 2 years of television production are available to students. School beautification is a project of the horticultural class. The Child Development Lab is a recent addition to the Home Economics Department. Language lab facilities are available for French, German, Spanish, and Latin. Astronomy and Mayo's Planetarium, The Spartan Scene, a daily live school newscast, Model Office, a work experience program, the student-operated school store, and the Bear Creek Outdoor Classroom facilities are some of the unique features of Mayo High School. The principals conduct weekly tours when parents can observe the academic program, which produces results exceeding state and national averages, and yet allows for relaxed atmospheres for students in the student commons. the Southtown Singers, who perform at various community functions, and drama productions are two of many varied activities which encourage participation for all students. The athletic program not only produces its share of conference and state champions, but has maintained its emphasis on participation for the largest number of students. The same trend has continued for the participation of girls in competitive sports. Mayo High School not only meets but exceeds the requirements for offering equal opportunities to all students in a wide variety of abilities and interests, but most important, it's our school and we like it.
Rochester Mayo, a great representative from Section 1 to this tournament. Let's go downstairs now to our interview area. Ed Cairo has a special guest. Ed?
We, too, have a great representative, Bob, and he is Larry Ross, coach in International Falls. And, Larry, the winningest coach, your teams have won, had the most wins down here, but there are a couple of guys in this tournament who might be able to catch you, one in particular who won't, but has certainly represented your coaching fraternity well, and that's George Perpich, who will retire this year.
Yeah, George retires. He announced his retirement. I think George is 62 now, Eddie, and he retired, and it's a good way for him to go, and I think all of us on the range are real glad for George. He's a fine person, and he has a good team here, probably has the best representative of our area, so I think by and large we're all pulling for both Hibbing and George.
Now, you know what it's like to have 400 wins. He's going for his 400th tonight against Henry Sibley.
Yeah, that's great. I hope he gets it. I'll be the first to congratulate him. George is a little nervous. I hope the kids aren't as nervous as he is, but he's a little nervous. But this time, I think the kids kind of ignore the coach anyhow. And I look for him to have a hard game, but to win.
Thanks so much, Larry Ross from International Falls, for being with us. Bob, let's go back to you.
Thank you, Ed. Rochester Mayo, of course, leading after one period of play over Edina. 2-1, that's the score. We'll be back with the second period action. This is the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament.
Now, just when you need it, the home sale at Target. Save 50 cents on every skein of Sale yarn. Choose from an assortment of solid colors and ombres, only 89 cents a skein. Organize your closets with colorful tubular plastic hangers. Target home sale priced, 10 for $1. Stock up on Clorox Soft Scrub and Dow Bathroom Cleaner, now 99 cents each. For great savings, shop the home sale at Target.
Incredible ice machine. Corn growers will tell you, keep treating rootworms with the same chemical. And one of these days, it may not stop them like it used to. But before you switch, you should know that Kalter, Diphenate, and Lorspan are all organophosphates, all in the same family. To hit rootworms with a different chemical, switch to Furadan. The only carbamate. Don't just switch brands, switch chemicals. Switch to Furadan from FMC.
Comfort and luxury are back. And in places like Brown County, Thunderbird is leading the way.
I love my T-Bird. Everybody else loves it too. I'm a very proud owner. I drove by one day and I saw the T-Bird sitting there and I thought, I've got to go back and take a second look. So I came back with my girlfriend and she said, just take it on a test drive. So we did, and that was love at first sight. I just had to get it.
Back live at the St. Paul Civic Center, Bob Bruce along with Al Shaver and Lou Nanny as we're getting ready for the second period of action between Rochester Mayo and, of course, Edina. Later on today, of course, we have three more games for you. We've got Jefferson versus East Grand Forks, Henry Sibley versus Hibbing later on tonight at 7 o'clock, and Cloquet versus Mariner. So our airtime tonight for tonight's evening bracket will be 7 o'clock. Well, gentlemen, this game definitely far from over. Rochester Mayo really playing and standing up at this point to the physical bigness of Edina.
Well, Rochester Mayo had to come through a couple of tough games to get here, and that last one, they beat a fine team in Burnsville. Burnsville had some good size also, but Mayo, as we said, started off real slow this season. In fact, early, I think it was after the fourth game, their coach, Lauren Gross, says, I wonder if we'll even win a game this season. But after that, they got rolling. They played extremely well. Some young kids on their team start developing. They've come through a tough division, and they're playing a fine hockey club in Edina, but they're not over awed by them by any stretch of the imagination, and they played extremely well and deserve to be ahead.
There you see some of the fans here today. Total sellout for both games this afternoon and again for tonight. And it's just amazing the support and the excitement that's created by this tournament. There's nothing like it anywhere else in the entire country.
No, Bob, and you get so many people coming from other parts of the country that you might have talked about the tournament, told them about it, but until they actually get here, they can't really get the excitement. They don't have the feel for this tournament unless they're right here. And this is something that the state's got to be tremendously proud of, is proud of. It's developed by leaps and bounds over the years. I first came down in 1959. It's a long time ago. And it was very exciting then. And by some means, they just find ways to continue to get more and more impressive with each passing season.
You were in about the seventh grade in 59, right?
I was in the fourth grade.
Oh.
I remember listening to Al when I was growing up.
Listen, you came there at the same time I did. You just came a little later in the year. He came after the Olympics in 68. I see the Jefferson band. I love the color of that Jefferson, the band uniforms and their team uniforms. That, what do you call that, robin's egg blue or powder blue?
The Jaguars.
The Jaguars, the defending champions. They're on next against the East Grand Forks Green Wave.
That should be a very interesting game. As you said, many people just dispelling any chance for East Grand Forks, but East Grand Forks is here, and they might surprise a lot of people.
I love this shot here, fellas. You see this over the goal? Yeah. I just love that.
Look at those exercises, the goaltender. I do that every morning, Louis.
And then you don't come to work the rest of the day.
Well, we're ready for the second period. Rochester Mayo leads it 2-1, and with a play-by-play, of course, Al Shaver. Al, take it over.
Johansson and Mealy on the opening draw. 2-1 Rochester as we go to the middle stanza here at the Civic Center. The puck comes back inside the Edina blue line. Brouwer turning with it. Feeding across on the right. A relay to Mealy at the blue line now. Got by check along the board from Wick. Now the puck comes in offside. Cutshall picking it up, but we had a man down Mealy inside the blue line offside.
I would think for Edina to get going better than they have been, they're going to have to move the puck more. They're trying to do too much individual work by themselves, carrying the puck when they should be moving it quickly and getting into holes. And they usually do that during the season, but they didn't do it in the first period, and they were checked very closely by Rochester.
An attempt to shoot it in by Edina blocked at center, and now Johnson dumping it into the Edina zone to the left. Brouwer back, checked in the corner by Johansson. It's cleared to the near boards. Mayo keeping it in, though. Brouwer in the corner again, trying to get away from Jim Johansson. Feeds it ahead, a tip, and still in the zone. Johnson puts it across to Wick. He left it for Johansson, but it's broken up, held in by Glenn, a long shot. And on his knees, the save made by Lozinski. There's a break in the action. The score, Rochester 2, Edina 1.
Elegant atmosphere, exciting menus, superb wine list, and affordable dining is waiting for you at Stone Wings. Stone Wings, Bloomington.
Play underway in the Edina zone. A shot from the point is blocked and then cleared by Lozinski to his left. It's still in the zone, and a pass got by Jennison moving in from the right point, and now a long shot as he picked it up again, and we have a stoppage, and we'll have a face-off as the save is made by Lozinski.
One thing we can notice here, Rochester Mayo forwards very alertly are covering up on the blue line. Every time one of their defensemen, like Jennison, stood up there or went in and forced a play or pinched along the boards, one of the forwards took his position, so they're not getting out man. As long as they continue to do that, they'll be okay.
Brasso winning the draw from Chapman, and a shot right on, and another save by Lozinski. Rochester keeping the heat on here. They're a smaller school than Edina. 1,494 is the enrollment at Mayo. 2,071 the enrollment at Edina. Grosso against Chapman again. The puck comes to Lamb. Back to the point. The Magno shot hits the traffic and goes to the right corner. And now the Hornets come out. A pass at center. Carroll chasing it to the far boards. Over skating, but it's brought in by Chapman. However, we have an offside as Carroll was over the blue line ahead of him.
Well, defenseman Jennison took Carroll right over the blue line, and that was a good play because he just forced that offside. Otherwise, Chapman was and DeVoe were able to move along with that puck.
Chapman on the draw against Grosso again outside the Rochester blue line. The puck in the neutral zone comes to the near boards. A backhander by Baker. Shot into the zone now by Carroll. DeMagno chased back of the goal by Chapman. Stops, turns, trying to shake Chapman off. Puts it in the right corner. That it's brought out now to center ice on the attack for Williams. Shooting it in. Lozinski way out to his left falls on it. Before the hustling Williams could get in to pick up the puck he fired in himself. They've played 1:31 of the second period. There's a break in the action with the score. Rochester 2, Edina 1.
Titan Hockey Sticks and these fine dealers are proud to help bring you the Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament. Titan, the hockey stick of Titans.
Face off to the left of Lozinski.
The referee can't get the door closed over in Rochester Mayo's bench. And that's what we have a little holdup for right now. I think everything's okay there right now.
Seaver, Beck, and Stauffer line on now for Mayo. Face off to Lozinski's left. And from the point, a rising shot. They score! From the right point, a shot up and in by Hugh Smith. And Rochester leads it 3-1.
What a rocket that shot was. Hit awfully hard and bounces around and in to give Rochester Mayo now a 3-1 lead on the faceoff. Well, we'll try to pick it up again off the faceoff. The puck came back to the point, and then there was a shot. It was, here we go, on the faceoff. Puck comes back. Hugh Smith, boom, and watch it bounce. Right there.
It hit McCarthy's stick as he was knocked down. It just caught part of McCarthy's stick and changed direction on goaltender Lozinski.
Okay, the assist on it goes to the center, Seaver, who got the draw. Seaver assisting on the point shot for the goal by Smith. Now Edina down by two, have to open up. They come in with McCarthy, but his two men are offside. Both wingers in early as Rolf and Picotti preceded the puck across the line.
Well, Chris Beck just pushed Rolf over the line just as Jennison had done earlier. A real good play by the winger Beck there to force that offside. Rochester Mayo winning those draws, eventually you're going to get a goal, and that's what happened in the third goal for Rochester.
This time McCarthy got the draw from Johansson, the puck shot into the zone, right in the slot. McCarthy is shot, oh, and a great save on the play by McCauley. McCarthy working right up the slot, splitting the defense and getting in for a close-in chance from point-blank range, but John McCauley took it away from him.
A real good pass over on the wing, and McCarthy cutting inside the defenseman. Got that shot away quick, too, but McCauley came out and smothered it.
Well, you knew that had to happen. I had to call him Tom McCarthy instead of Mike, didn't you? I'm a little confused at this time of the year. Puck in the corner to the right of the Rochester goal. This is big Jim Johansson coming back of the net, surrounded on both sides, puts it in the right corner. Johnson back to help out. Brad Johnson loses. McCarthy holding it in to Brower at the point. His shot blocked, but he gets it back. Comes into the right circle. Closing in, a shot off McCauley to the far board. Held in by Cassid. Around behind McCarthy trying to center. Deflects back of the net off the skate of Jennison. And the play is tied up along the boards behind the Rochester goal. 12:33 left in the second period. There's a break in the action. The score, Rochester Mayo 3, 9-1.
Get set for the good times with Kemp's Ice Cream. Creamier, smoother Kemp's. The best tasting, best selling ice cream around.
Face off to the left of McCauley. The puck comes back. A shot from Kutchell. Or make that John DeVoe, and it goes up out of play.
Another case there of losing the draw gives the opposition a good chance on net. have to realize anytime you lose a draw, you might not even get that puck back for 20, 25 seconds. It's just possession, just as in basketball. You want to make sure you always win those draws.
Lamb and Maley on the draw this time. Here's Maley, a shot, it's good! Maley won the draw right at the top of the left circle and snapped off a quick shot as he worked behind Lamb and put it in past McCauley to make it a 3-2 hockey game. And that was a big one. Edina had to score that goal. If they'd gone down by three, they would have had real problems.
It was a big shot right on the ice, and McCauley tried to kick it out of there, just couldn't quite get a skate on it. Here it is again, Luke.
Watch Maley step around the centerman right there. That was the key in the play. He got free. He just pushed the puck through his legs and stepped around. The centerman's got to take that man out if he doesn't win the draw. He didn't there. Maley came right around and snapped that off real quickly. A fine shot in the far side to beat McCauley, make the score. Rochester 3, Edina 2.
The goal was unassisted. Maley making his own play. Time of the goal will be 2:33. 3-2 now for Rochester. The puck back in the Edina zone. Baker clears off the near boards at center ice. Here's a 2-on-1. Maley moving in, fanned on it. In the right circle, it's fired up against the glass behind. Maley trying to work it loose. Down goes Glenn. Maley comes to the right corner. His pass off a skate comes back in the left corner. Down goes Cutshell, and Grosso takes over the puck. A dump to center ice, got by Smith. Now it's picked up and shot in by Lamb, but it's offside.
Maley breaking down the ice, 2-on-1 with DeVoe, had a fine chance. He was trying to lay it across. As he looked up to DeVoe, he just took his eye off that puck momentarily, lost sight of it, and fanned on the pass. It would have been a good chance for Rochester right there, or for Edina right there, as they were putting some pressure on Rochester.
Seaver facing off against Chapman outside the Edina blue line. And the Hornets come away with the puck. In over the line, played in by Mike DeVoe, gives pursuit. He's checked by Beck, and the puck taken over by Seaver, starting back on the left side. Cutting away from the boards to the right, dumping it in, but he can't get to the puck as Cassid tied him up nicely. The puck is still in the Edina zone, comes in front, and it's cleared away now to the left wing side and on out to center. Carroll loses out in the neutral zone, and Jennison puts it back in, but it's picked off by the Hornets. Here they come now with Chapman over the line. Shakes off a check, moving in right circle. Falls, got it in front there. Oh, and an open net shot by Carroll, and he shot it wide on the left side. Carroll is down and hurt behind the Rochester goal. What a chance Danny Carroll had on that left side. He just shot it wide after a great play by Chapman, and then Carroll went down in behind the net, and we'll hopefully get a replay and maybe see what happened to him back there.
Here it is again, Alan. Chapman, what a great stick handler he is. Gets the pass across in front of the net. Open net. He misses it. And let's see if he falls here. I think he's hit by a Rochester player.
Well, Carroll was taken out behind the net right there on the boards. And just the way he fell, he just probably twisted a knee a little bit. A fine play by Chapman. You see, he's falling down. He knew that Carroll was trailing on the play. That's why he hooked the pass back to him. Carroll, having a good angle, just missed the whole net. He tried to keep the puck ahead, but here's where he's taken in the boards by the defenseman right here. As he's taken in, and it just seems the way he fell, he might have...
Might have hit his head, too.
Yeah, might have hurt himself right there.
He was checked there by Pete Stauffer, number 17. Carroll's all right.
Danny Carroll comes from a family of about 5 hockey-playing brothers. In fact, his goaltender brother played down in Mankato, a very fine prospect. He had him at training camp a couple years back.
Yeah?
Yep.
Oh, the man says, his dad, Carroll's dad, referees in
right.
Minneapolis. 4:33 gone in the second period. It's 3-2. Rochester leads. Mike McCarthy and Jim Johansson on the draw. The puck comes back high all the way down the ice. Cassid chasing it to the right of Lozinski. Comes back of the net, clearing around on the left wing side. It's held in by Mayo, and now tipped out to center. McCarthy returning the puck, and we have an injured player down inside the Edina blue line.
I think it's Hugh Smith. He got checked heavily right inside the blue line, and he tried to go a few feet, make it to the bench, and he didn't, and he went down. He might have got a stick in the throat or just caught a little bit in the shoulder, or he might have even hurt his shoulder. He was hit quite heavily. That is Hugh Smith. That's Jim Marshall out there, trainer, University of Minnesota, that works this tournament. He's been working it for many, many years. Rochester Hockey Club playing with a great deal of enthusiasm and intensity. Very impressive today.
Hey, being their first tournament, Louis, they got to really be pumped up. This is tournament number 12.
I think that Rochester Marshall, when they won the championship, they beat Edina that year, didn't they, in the finals? Yeah. So Rochester Mayo looking at this time to beat another Edina team. There's a check right there. A real good check, as a matter of fact, by Vacanti. And Hugh Smith, you see, took a few steps and then went down.
We're underway again as the puck is shot back into the Edina zone. Brower back for it behind the net. Takes a look, comes left, tied up on the play by Wick. Gets a pass off to Vacanti on the left. A relay for McCarthy, broken up at center. Johansson loses to Brower. In over the blue line, goes right to get by Jennison. Into the circle to the left of the goal. A centering pass into Jennison, skates, and he clears it away to the far side. A drive from the point is right on. And Roth's shot is turned away to the left side by McCauley. Now it's held in. Here's a chance right in front. And the shot grazes the left side of the goal as McCarthy had a big chance. Back of the goal, Johansson comes out to the right, then drops it in behind. A return pass got by Johansson at the blue line and comes out to center. Brower giving it to McCarthy, broken up by Wick. And now here's Johansson, the leading scorer of the two teams. He loses it at the blue line, and the puck is shot back into the Rochester zone by Edina. Big Johansson had 21 goals and 25 assists for 46 points during the season. That's the regular season for Rochester. He leads all scorers in this particular game. Now Jennison clearing around to the left side. Wick tried to tip it on out, does on the second effort. Johansson losing out at the Edina blue line, and back come the Hornets. Over the line, Kutchell faked a shot, moving in deep now. Checked on the play by DeMagno, and Johansson has the puck back of the goal. He's tied up in behind the net. It's fed around on the far point to Rizzut. Rizzut firing into the traffic. And now Brad Johnson tying it up with Kutchell along the far boards. And he'll have a face-off to the left of McCauley.
Speaking about Johansson, Nell, his dad is one of the fellows that really developed that program down in Rochester. Spent a great deal of time with the youth. Kenny Johansson is a fine hockey player down in the USHL. And probably has coached every one of those kids on the Mayo team at one time or other as they were coming up.
This is his second boy, isn't it? Didn't he
That's
have
right.
He played earlier?
His older son plays for the University of Wisconsin.
From the faceoff to the left of McCauley, the puck going to the far boards. Now comes loose at the right point. Rizzut shot low and gloved as it was dropping at the front edge of the crease. McCauley putting the glove out and snaring it, and they'll face off to his left again. There's a break in the action. The score, Rochester 3, Edina 2.
Klassen's Athletic and Repair specializes in reconditioning all hockey equipment. If you're in charge of athletic equipment, call Klassen's for further information. Klassen's in Forest Lake.
Now here's a chance for Edina. A shot deflects to the right circle. Moving in now, Kutchell to Maley. Maley got turned around but got a shot off and hit the outside of the goal on McCauley's right. Puck cleared to the far side into the corner. And now picking it up is Kurt Whitney, who's on, I believe, for the first time today. Kurt Whitney wearing number 15. It's still in the zone. Now here's a pass to the near side, and Kutchell got it on the second effort. Ran into a check from Glenn. Now takes another check. It's Maley feeding the point. Baker's shot hit Glenn. Baker holding it in. Here's Kutchell to the right of the goal, trying to put it in front. Maley fanned on it. Rizzut coming in for a follow-up shot, and his shot hit a defender and dropped outside the goal in front of the net, and it's smothered by McCauley.
Well, there we saw a couple of occasions again where Rochester forwards are too deep, helping out their defensemen, leaving the points open, and Rochester got themselves in a great deal of problem because Edina defensemen were able to take that puck, take a few steps and walk right in, put a couple shots on the net, but John McCauley doing a fine job on the net, and especially right there for Rochester, keeping the score 3-2 for Rochester.
Chapman for Edina, Seaver for Rochester on the faceoff. It goes to the far boards. Cassid shot hit the traffic along the wall, and now Seaver backhands a clearing shot, rolling on edge deep into the Edina zone to the right. Brower back, checked by Stauffer, plays it around behind on the left wing side for Carroll. Danny Carroll's pass right on to Seaver's stick, or Stauffer's stick, tried to put it in front, but it's blocked and cleared out by Brower, and then shot in again offside, and we'll have a face-off outside the Edina blue line. There's a break in the action. The score is Rochester Mayo 3, Edina 2.
First play, their first game in the NCAA basketball tournament this Sunday. Can they become national champs? Watch for special reports from Indianapolis this weekend on Eyewitness News.
Puck in the Edina zone, a hand pass involved there from Beck. And we'll have a face-off for an illegal advance.
He looked a little like a volleyball player there. He saw his wing on the side and he just knocked it over to
him. And spike it.
Chapman on the draw with Seaver. Seaver in possession, shooting it in. Brower clearing it away to the right. It's relayed out by Cassid. And now from the blue line, it's cleared back by DeMagno. And it's shot out into the Edina zone. Brower skating it down, trying to get away from Seaver. He falls. Stauffer holds it in to Seaver. Comes back to the net out the right side. Puts it in the slot. And broken up in the slot area by the Hornets. And back they come now with Chapman. Chapman getting by a check from DeMagno, who falls into the boards. Comes back to the net. Chapman falls. There's going to be a penalty here as Chapman is interfered with. And we'll have a power play coming up for the Hornets of Edina.
Actually, in that play, Al, as Chapman's going around the outside, Rolf was interfered with and pushed right into the net. It'll probably be an interference penalty at this time, giving Edina the chance to tie this game up.
Stauffer getting the penalty at 8:27. Two-minute minor for interference.
Here's a replay of that penalty again. Wally Chapman, the same thing he did against Wyzetta in the sectional final. What a great puck handler. He could really handle his stick. He's tripped right there.
That penalty was in front of the net, though. Carroll was interfered with. Now a shot from the near circle is turned in behind the net. Picked up in the corner by John DeVoe. Out to the left point now. Maley at the point for Edina. Feeds the right point and is knocked off with a Verzut stick and out to center ice. Back court is Maley. Shakes off one check. Crosses the Rochester line. Dropping it in the slot. Here's a shot. Oh, and it just went wide on the right side. On a shot from the point, and it's cleared down the ice by Rochester. Nice trailing pass there picked up by Chapman, and he got the shot off, but he was wide. Now here they come again. Maley guns a high shot. Off the glass, it rebounds to the right circle. And Maley, or Cutchell, trying to get control. Now it's tipped out to center ice. And here's a chance for Williams, but it's broken up by Rizzut. Tom Rizzut back to take a breakaway chance away from Pete Williams. Now the puck back at center, shot in by Maley. It rings the boards, going to McCauley's left. And in the corner, it's cleared ahead by Glenn's. Soderdalen is on now, number 11 for Rochester. He leaves the puck along the far boards, and Johansson clears it the length of the ice. Soderdalen, as mentioned earlier, a cousin of Jefferson coach Tom Soderdalen, who will be behind the bench in our next game coming up. Still on the power play. In comes Edina now. Right circle, backhand shot off the glove. Chance there for Roth, and now here's Brower firing, and McCauley turns that away to his right. In the corner, Smith is jammed from behind by Roth, and the puck is frozen. We'll have a face-off to the right of McCauley with 4:51 left in the second period, 18 seconds remaining in Stauffer's penalty.
And a good play by Hugh Smith there when he's being checked by two Edina men, and he knew he couldn't get the puck out. He was wise to just eat it, freeze it along the boards, and get a whistle and get a change in personnel because they were a little tired at that time.
That's Tommy's nephew, not his cousin. All right. Our mistake. Tommy Satterdallen's nephew. Left point. It's fed to Roth now. Right circle. Back to Brower. His shot hit the traffic as Jennison blocked it. It's cleared to the left side. Jennison after it. Puts it out to center. Too far for Seaver. And the Hornets starting back in now. In over the line. But Roth was having control problems. And it's cleared down the ice by Rochester. The penalty has expired. Stauffer back on. Rochester has killed it off. Here's Cassid feeding up the left side. A relay held in at the point now by DeMagno. And now a clearing effort comes out to center. DeMagno tried to bank it in. Roth picks it off and fires it rink wide off the far boards. Jennison back of the Rochester goal. Runs into Bacotti. Loses the puck. Bacotti putting it out in front of shot. Oh, and a wide shot by McCarthy. He had the goaltender at his mercy, and he shot it wide on McCauley's right side. Now Rochester clearing it all the way down the ice, and this will cost them a faceoff in their own zone to the left on an icing call.
Well, Connie took a look, and he saw McCarthy all alone in front. He laid that puck out just perfectly to him. McCarthy tried to put it up on the far side and just missed the net. John McCauley, by the way, standing up there and challenging the shooter quite well, not going down, not making that first move, and making it very difficult to score on.
Maley facing off against Johansson. Maley was the... Here's a shot! John DeVoe picking up the loose puck along the boards to the left of the goal, flipping a shot that hit McCauley and caromed in off him.
Well, it was DeVoe, and now Edina has pulled back into a 3-3 tie. First, Maley scoring a big goal to pull them within one, and watch him pick up the loose puck. There's the shot, past McCauley, and it's all tied up.
The faceoff going to the side, a free faceoff on the right side for DeVoe. He gets that shot, and it just... McCauley trickled in.
It's all tied up at three with 3:40 left in the second period. Back in the Rochester zone again, right corner. Cutshell trying to work it loose, but Johansson takes it away and dumps to center. Too far for Wick, and it's shot back in by Rizzo. Cleared to the left corner now. A lot of jostling going on along the boards there. Some real good thumping. Now back to the blue line. It's held in by Baker. Fires it around behind, and on the left side is picked up by Smith. He's trying to come out, but he got flattened on a hit by Rizzuto as they met head on. Puck cleared to the right now. Glenn overskates it. It's fired back in behind by Cutshell. And now Wick golfing it around on the far boards, the length of the ice. And we have another icing call, and Rochester appears to be hanging on the ropes a little right now, as Edina has come back from a 3-1 deficit to tie it. 2:56 left in the second period.
Well, Edina put on sustained pressure for about 4 minutes there. They had some real fine chances, a few of which were stopped by McCauley and a couple of which were shot wide of the net, and they finally get one from the right side. Really not a good angle, but it seemed to hit McCauley's pad and just trickle over it after Rochester had lost the faceoff again. That's three goals this period that have resulted from faceoffs.
Chapman and Grasso on the draw, that was Williams. Williams is flattened along the far boards by Mike DeVoe. Here's a chance for Grasso. Fires, just wide to the right. Puck goes to the far boards, now comes loose. Grasso wheels and deals, a shot right on, and Lozinski makes the save and smothers the rebound. Well, your nephew coming close there, Louis.
Cousin.
Cousin, I've got nephews and cousins all mixed up here today. Who's nephew?
He took so long to shoot the puck, Lozinski had already made a move. He almost put it in the open net.
Here's a replay of it, Al. Here's the shot. Nice move. Two strong goalies in this game.
From the faceoff, a drive just wide to the right. Shot by Williams, who pursues the puck in the corner, puts it in front. It comes back out to the left point. DeMagno firing, and it's steered to the right corner by Cassid. And now Grasso after it, but he loses out, and it's brought out. Here's a 2-on-1 break. Chapman moving in with Carroll. The pass to Carroll. He scores! Pretty goal. Beautiful passing. Chapman to Carroll. And he tucked it in just inside the right post on McCauley.
Al, I mentioned earlier how good of a stick handler Carroll is. And there's another example of it. He's made the same move several times in this game already. But watch this with Chapman. Over to Carroll. Molly Chapman, just a super player. Beautiful pass. In past McCauley. And like that, Edina has come on strong to lead it 4-3. All throughout the season, Louis, they've been a strong second period club.
And there's the key right there with Chapman. After he made the pass to Carroll, Carroll didn't stop it. He just changed directions of it, not giving the goalie a chance to get set. He just let her go, changed the directions, and he beat McCauley. Goaltender had no chance on that one. A fine play by Wally Chapman. A real good tip by Carroll.
Three-way passing play. Carroll finishing off a three-way play with his center Chapman and his right winger, Mike DeVoe. Now here's Vacanti coming in. Broken up in the slot. Vacanti getting it again. Tried to feed it through for McCarthy, but it's broken up. And a long pass in the left for Stauffer. Moving into the right of the goal, broken up by Rizzoud, who brings it back in the net. Now comes out on the right. Headman's up the middle for McCarthy. He's got Vicante coming up on the left. Here's the shot by McCarthy, and he fired it wide to McCauley's right. It's cleared to the left corner and tied up in the corner by members of both teams. We'll have a face-off to the left of McCauley with 1:39 remaining in the second period. 4-3 for Edina. They're second lead of the game. They got the opening goal and then gave up three straight.
Edina moving the puck much crisper and a lot wiser in their own zone because they're coming up the middle. The middle's open and they're able to break out 2 and 3 on 1 and they're catching Rochester in deep.
From the faceoff, Mealy tying up with DeMagno and they'll do it over.
Rochester's going to have to pull either a winger right in the center or move a defenseman there to try and stop Edina from coming out that middle so easily.
Mealy and Johansson. Mealy's line accounted for the first three Edina goals. Johansson scored. Johansson's line scored accounted for two of the Rochester goals. The shot on from the faceoff is smothered by McCauley. And they'll take another draw to his left.
And that shot deflected off Jennison's stick, and McCauley didn't have as an easy shot as it looked. Jennison reached out to try and stop it and change directions of it, but McCauley made the save.
Johansson and Mealy squaring off again in the circle to the left of McCauley. Puck goes to the corner. Wick's pass picked off. A shot by John DeVoe, partially blocked and now cleared to center. Baker coming back to his blue line, feeding it to Cassid on the right. He dumps it into the Rochester zone. It's promptly cleared out. And now John DeVoe comes in. Runs into a check, knocking down DeMagno, chases the puck along the far boards in the left corner, but Johansson clears past him. Wick tried to tip it out, fanned on it, because Rizzoud trying to hold it in, and now back in the left corner, DeMagno brings it back of the net. It's knocked off his stick to the left corner. Wick has it. Wick firing it around behind. And on the right side, it's picked up by Brad Johnson. Headmans, it got past Johansson. Baker playing it back in from the neutral zone. And again, DeMagno back for Rochester. Long pass out on the right side for Johnson. Johnson firing it in from outside the Edina blue line. It's cleared back to the left of the goal by Lozinski. Rizzoud is tied up behind. Now Chapman goes down. A centering pass is right in front. And Lozinski dives outside the crease to cover it as we have some pushing in front involving Big Johansson. He just bustled his way right in there. He's a big man.
A lot like his father. His father's about 20 pounds heavier when he played. Real strong, stands in front of that net, and that's what Johansson does here. He stands out in front. You see a pass come out from the corner, almost deflected in off the Edina defenseman, and Johansson comes out and tries to work that puck free. Big, strong, and he can gain position in front of that net.
He just pushed Baker right away from the puck there. Now here's a chance for Lamb, and he fires it wide to the left. A centering attempt right in front of the goal!
Grosso on a pass from the corner.
Let's look at it again, and what a big goal for Rochester Mayo with just 18 seconds remaining here in the second period to pull back within a tie, with a tie. They're losing momentum, and here's the goal right here. Watch the puck come out front, come up high.
Russell took good position right in front of the net, and he put that right through Lozinski's legs. He takes a pass. He's all alone in front of the net. He's standing there, and he just beat Lozinski from point-blank range.
Russell from Williams and Lamb. We're back to live action. The score tied at 4, and here comes Chapman over the line. Moving into the left circle, puts it in front. Carroll, a backhander, just went wide to the right. 4-4 the score, and there's the horn to end the second period. And the two teams will come back for one more 15-minute session, hoping to break that 4-4 deadlock. And it should be a dandy third period of action. And, of course, if it's tied then, they'll go into sudden death overtime.
Rochester Mayo with a big goal at the end of this period. Standing by live to ask Coach Willard Eichel about that goal is Rob Lear. Rob?
Thank you very much, Bob. Of course, Willard Eichel, the Edina head coach. And has this score at all surprised you? I know it has, and we know that we're going to be in for a real tough hockey game today. They skate real well, and they can put the puck in the net. And I thought the first period, maybe we didn't play so well right at the end. But then we came back and really stormed them pretty good and got up on them. But, geez, you hate to see that goal go in the last minute of play there against us. Now, we just got to get the momentum going again, and it's a 15-minute hockey game right now, and we got to go 100%. They're a fine hockey team, and we got to play our best to beat them.
Thank you very much, Willard. Bob, back upstairs.
What a game we've got going here. It's all tied up. That's the end of the second period with the score. Rochester Mayo 4, Edina 4.
Look, that's it. That's the one. That's the new Honda 250.
Dave, you're not going to start this again.
Don't you know how easy this is to ride?
Dave, you're not buying one of these.
Oh, but think of the mileage. You know how much money we'd save? Mm. Oh, honey, I get you clothes, dresses, perfume, a canary.
David.
Oh, it's brand new. Some lucky guy just got this thing.
Yeah, I know. Happy birthday, Lucky.
See the new Honda CM250 Custom at Osseo Honda and Stillwater Honda.
Farming is a risky business.
Careful.
You have to carefully consider every move you make.
Easy.
There are dangers in expanding your operation. Risks in marketing your crop more aggressively.
Watch it.
A slip could mean disaster. So isn't it comforting to know you have all-risk crop insurance with you every step of the way?
Motorcraft reveals the enemy of gas mileage, fuel-robbing friction in your engine. Motorcraft introduces the Gas Saver, Motorcraft's new super premium oil. It fights friction so well, it can actually save you gas. New Motorcraft super premium oil. It can save you gas. Motorcraft, for the future of your car, for sure.
Motorcraft 10W40 motor oil, 69 cents with rebate at all Kmart stores.
Music. That's what KS95 FM is all about. Number one stereo music. Music and minute-by-minute changes in weather.
And you can expect
music and weather and a whole lot of fun.
You just won KS95 FM's cash call.
Bam fans, we won! We won!
KS95 FM, the most listened to music station. Under the sun.
We're back after the second period. We've got a great hockey game going on here. Rochester and Edina tied 4-4. Let's get right to the highlights. Rochester got a two-goal lead, Louie, and it looked like they were really going to take off in the second period, but Edina came back. 1:45 of the second period. We pick up the action. Look for him off the faceoff. Look for number 8, Hugh Smith. There's the faceoff. There's the shot, and there's the goal. It's 3-1.
Well, three times that period, the loss of faceoffs resulted in goals. 3 out of 5 goals. Shows you how important those faceoffs are. The puck coming back to the point, the slap shot hit McCarthy's stick as he was taken out. The Edina centerman taken out and deflected past Lozinski.
Then Edina came right back to make it 3-2, 2:33 of the period. Number 19, Dave Maley.
Maley just steps right past the centerman here when he wins the faceoff and lets the shot go, and that makes it 3-2. The centerman's got to take that man out on that play.
Then at 11:10, Edina made it 3-3. Loose puck picked up by John DeVoe, number 18, and Edina's coming on strong.
Well, DeVoe gets the faceoff from Maley, goes over to the right. He just puts the shot on the net, and as McCauley's going down, hits his pad right there and trickles right over him.
And watch this pretty play by Edina. Number 3, Wally Chapman, over to number 20, Dan Carroll. Beautiful 2-on-1 break, and it looked like Edina was going to power away with that period. They were leading 4-3.
Well, Edina had been putting on sustained pressure. They missed some good chances, but right here, Chapman makes a fine pass to Carroll, who just changes direction of the puck right there. He doesn't even hesitate to stop it or snap it, not giving the goalie a chance to set up, and puts it in.
And then a very big goal for Rochester Mayo, 14:42, just a few seconds left. Number 9, Jim Grosso.
Well, Jimmy Grosso right in front of the net, gets good position, takes a pass from Williams in the corner, and puts it through Lozinski's legs.
You see it again right there. A beautiful pass out front.
And when you score a goal late in the period like that, it usually gives that team a great deal of momentum. That's why Willard Eichel, coach of Edina, was so upset, and I'm sure that's why Lauren Gross, the coach of Rochester right now, is very elated. His team keeps battling back. They're playing extremely well. They were under a lot of pressure for the middle part of that period, but they hung in there. They've got a tie game. Much more than people thought going at this time, so I'm sure the Edina players are sitting in there very concerned. I have to think that they thought they might have a little easier time than they're having, and Rochester's playing extremely well, and they're giving Edina all they can handle.
Especially they have to be thinking about that final goal.
They certainly do, and they know right now the next goal could win it.
Well, it's all tied up 4-4. The exciting action of the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament will continue after station identification.
Thatch can choke a lawn to death. Of course, you can remove thatch by messing up your lawn with a power rake or messing up your back. Or you can use the self-propelled Snapper Hi-Vac with the economical Thatcherizer attachment. It plucks the harmful thatch from the lawn, then vacuums it into the grass catcher for easy disposal. The result is a beautiful revitalized lawn. And it's also great on the Snapper Hi-Vac Rider. You and your lawn come out in great shape. Snapper, discover the difference.
Look out, world! Hey, look out!
Here comes the $750 price break from Ford. Get $750 back on every new Mustang. $750 back on every new Fairmont Futura. $750 back on every new Granada and Granada wagon. But hurry, you must take delivery between now and April 3rd. It's the $750 price break from Ford.
Here comes Ford!
Checkmate by Good Sports. Get the ultimate in mid-body protection. Thighs, kidneys, and hips fully protected by lightweight Checkmate. With the fit you can customize. Good Sports shoulder pads mean super protection of the AC joint, sternum, and collarbone. Join the hockey revolution with Good Sports, the ultimate in protection. Get Checkmate and all the other great equipment from Good Sports. Good Sports hockey equipment is available at better sporting goods stores everywhere.
Channel 5, KSTP-TV, St. Paul, Minneapolis.
We now return to the St. Paul Civic Center Arena and the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament.
Just minutes away from the start of our final period of our first of four games that we have for you today. But before we get to that third period, let's find out more about one of the schools involved in this game. Let's look at a little bit more Edina High School. Let's find out about it right now.
The city of Edina has a population of about 45,000 and is located on the southwest edge of Minneapolis. Many people are familiar with the Edina shopping centers of Southdale and Yorktown. The recently renovated 50th and France area also draws numerous shoppers to Edina. The ever-expanding Pentagon Park, Radisson South area, is home to a large number of office buildings and commercial enterprises. Edina has excellent park and recreation facilities. They include Braemar Arenas and golf course, the municipal swimming pool, many parks, and fine park board athletic programs. Edina High School, a combination of the former Edina East and Edina West schools, is a three-year high school of 2,050 students and a proud tradition. Edina schools were named one of the top 12 high schools in the nation by Money Magazine last fall because of their gifted teachers, individual attention to students, rich curriculum, and strong emphasis on preparation for college. Curriculum offerings, for example, include 14 math courses, from Algebra 1 to Calculus, 4 years of Spanish, German, French, and Latin, a wide range of home economics, industrial education, art and photography courses, and advanced placement courses offered in 12 different subjects. Many students receive college credit by taking advanced placement tests after completing these courses. Edina students received one half the total advanced placement credits awarded in Minnesota last year. In 1980-81, 17 Edina seniors were named National Merit Semifinalist, and 31 received commendations. In addition to the academic honors Edina students have achieved, they have also excelled in extracurricular areas. The debate teams of Edina continue a proud tradition by qualifying two teams for the state tournament and by winning first and second place in regional competition. The concert choir was recently selected by Dale Warland, professor of music at McAllister College, to be the featured guest choir at the McAllister Invitational. The bands and orchestra have repeatedly won high ratings. Many students participate in the musicals, plays, and pop concerts given each year. Charity Week, an Edina tradition, is being continued at the combined Edina High School this year. In the last 2 years, students at Edina raised over $7,000 for selected charities. The athletic teams of Edina have won over 40 state titles, more than any other school in the state. This year's teams have placed first in boys slalom skiing, first in girls tennis, and second in girls gymnastics. This year's hockey team, the representative of Region 6, is the 17th Edina hockey team to enter tournament play. As Edina enters a new era of single high school, our students and community will strive to continue the proud tradition.
There you have it, an up-close look at Edina High School. You know, our man about everywhere, Rob Lear, is going to be with us throughout these 3 days from the top of the building to the basement. And right now, I hear that he's with some Rochester Mayo fans. Rob?
Right you are, Bob. We are in Section 228, the Rochester Mayo cheering section. They call themselves FUBAR. And what that means, we have Julie Hildestad to tell us what FUBAR in Rochester Mayo in the cheering section means.
FUBAR means fired up beyond all recognition.
And I understand you guys all left early this morning.
Yep, we left about 9:30 from Rochester.
And how many of you came up?
There's 1,100 tickets sold in Rochester.
That's terrific. Now, I understand you got a cheer for all of us, and especially Bob Bruce upstairs, so let's give it.
Okay, ready, guys?
M-A-Y-O, go, go! M-A-Y-O, go, go! M-A-Y-O, go, go!
Rochester Mayo finding out how much fun it is as a first-timer in the state tournament. Bob, back upstairs.
Oh, I look forward to see where he's going to be next time we check in with him, because, of course, we've got three more games today. The teams are coming back out on the ice. We're tied 4-4 after two periods. Back in just a moment with a third period. This is the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament.
A team of Honda engineers set out to create the world's most advanced motorcycle, the CX 500 Turbo. A water-cooled, fuel-injected, turbocharged motorcycle systematically controlled by a digital computer. The CX 500 Turbo. The only thing about it that is not surprising is the name of the company that built it.
See the new Honda Turbo at Towsley Sports Center in Twin City Honda.
There's a hungry beast feeding in your house. It's your old furnace, and its appetite is costing you more and more every day. Your Lennox dealer can tame your heating costs with a new Lennox Conservator gas furnace, the most efficient gas furnace yet.
Dave Lennox on hand to remind you that now's a good time to call Bob Ritchie at B&C Heating in Spring Lake Park, or talk over your needs with one of the Turnquists at Peterson Penney in Anoka.
There's something better at Burnsville Center, something better for you. It's all the things that you can be, all the things you can do. There's something better, a whole lot better, something better at Burnsville Center, something better for you at Burnsville Center.
Hi, I'm Bobby Smith of the Minnesota North Stars. Did you know that each year more Americans die from heart disease, stroke, and related disorders than all other causes of death combined? The American Heart Association Minnesota affiliate is working to control America's number one killer. Your generous support will fund research efforts, public and professional education, and community service programs. The Minnesota Heart Association. We're fighting for your life.
Back live, there's a nice shot of the Edina High School hockey team at the other end of the ice. Of course, Rochester Mayo. We're all tied up 4-4. And I don't know, this could be just like last year, Louie. In the first day, we had a couple of sudden death overtimes, and I wouldn't be surprised at all to see one in this game.
Well, and goaltender John McCauley from Rochester has already had 23 saves. He's playing extremely well. He's been a big factor in this game. Edina out shooting Rochester 23-8. But the score is tied 4-4, and Rochester seems to just keep fighting back, staying right on top of Edina, putting some pressure on him whenever it looks like Edina's ready to make a move. And Rochester's got to be thinking right now, we can beat this club. Edina, on the other hand, has to say, hey, if we give up another goal, that goaltender McCauley might not give up any. We could lose this game. A very interesting hockey game. A surprising Rochester team playing extremely well. Played very well offensively in the first period. Checking very strong in the corners. Even though they're smaller, they were coming up with the puck. Created some opportunities. They never allowed Edina to move that puck as freely as we've seen him do before.
Well, there's a lot of pressure in this third period. Edina, of course, a team that has quite a bit more experience in this sort of a situation than Rochester Mayo. We'll have to see if that plays a role at all.
We've just got a little gem here from Peter Jocketty, who digs these things out of his vast and ancient memory, telling us that Edina has won more state tournaments than any other school in Minnesota. They've won 37, including all sports. But they've only won the state hockey tournament twice.
No, I think they've won it 12
times. 69 and 71.
Well, that, no, after the combined team, it says here 12. Yeah, maybe it was one other time. I thought they had won it three times. There.
Okay, we're underway. The play is in the Edina zone. Brower forced back of his goal by Wick, comes to the left side, runs into Johansson, loses the puck. Centering pass, Wick reaches back, can't get it. It comes out to center, Glenn shooting it rink wide, look out, right into his own bench. And his teammates scatter, and Coach Grosso getting a chuckle out of that one, almost gave him a shave there, Louie.
Lauren looks like he's enjoying himself. The reason why he grows a beard, he's got such a baby face, he looks like he's about 20. And I think he does that just to look older than the players.
Play underway, and it's shot down the ice by Brad Johnson. Lozinski out behind to cut it off. Now Brower is tied up behind the net by Johansson. The puck picked up and brought out on the right side now. And it's Chapman moving at center. In over the Rochester line. Broken up in the slot and cleared to center. Johansson down the left side. Over the Rochester line. Leaves a drop pass. It came outside the blue line and it's brought in by Wick, trapping Johansson on the offside. There's a break in the action with the score. Rochester 4, Edina 4.
Sign up now for a TCF Passcard checking account, and Twin City Federal will give you this neat calculator free. Now, how can you beat a price like that?
Face off outside the Edina line. It comes back into the zone. Baker clearing now. Jennison flipping it. And Rochester moving in on the attack, but again, it's offside as the puck was brought in by Williams, but we had Lamb in too early, and he's offside.
One thing the puck carrier's got to do in that position, Al, is get the blue line. When he's got his wing coming with speed, he's got to get the blue line. Otherwise, an offside's going to occur.
Lamb and McCarthy on the draw. The puck back into the Edina zone comes to Lozinski. Sweeps it away to his right now. Roth clears to the line. It comes off. They stick it to Magno back into the Rochester zone. McCarthy setting it up behind the net. Jennison ringing it around to the left side. Rizuk will hold it in at the point. Gives it to Roth. Man open on the left. Bacanti turning with it now. Firing it around on the boards. Jennison back of the net. Clears to the left. And it comes out off Rizuk's stick at the blue line. Now the puck in the neutral zone picked up. And Roth loses it. In comes Lamb to the right corner. Rizuk forcing him wide. Feed back to the left point, a drive, and that hits the traffic and goes wide to the right on the shot by DeMagno. Puck in behind the net is tied up there. We'll have a face-off in the Edina zone with 13-12 remaining in the game and the score tied at 4.
Lauren Gross has got to be pretty happy with that Lamb, the way he's been handling the puck and moving in the Edina zone. Lamb, as a matter of fact, was a key in Rochester tying that game up at the end of two. He kept the puck in there, took the shot, and Williams got the rebound, fed it to Gross in front of the net.
Grosso sure doesn't look like a coach. He looks more like a musician with that gear, huh?
Well, he used to play the piano growing up, but he wasn't very good at it.
Ah, from the faceoff, the puck comes out to the center. Smith falls, and it's Cutshell coming in. Cutshell in the slot, passing off, and the shot hits a defender. And now a drive from the point, and that's turned away on the shot by Duvall. As McCauley steered it to his left, it shot around behind again. Smith in the right corner, Cutshell moving in to check. Feeds it ahead on the right side, and Johnson is tied up along the boards with the puck for a stoppage and a faceoff, which will take place in the circle to the right of John McCauley. We've got a new man out there now for Edina, McCush. Greg McCush, number 14.
The Magno fixing his suspenders, causing a little break in the action here. Here's McCush. Just going back to the bench, he thought the coach was calling him, and now he's going off the ice right now.
He was in the game.
Yeah. For a moment there, he was in the game, but now a change has been made. Here comes Maley. Maley must have had to fix his skate. He just came up from the dressing room. So he's taking center ice in the Cushers place.
From the faceoff, back to Kutchell. A shot, smothered. No, it's loose. Cleared away to the right side. Here's Kutchell. Back in the slot. Maley is bumped off the puck. Another Rochester man goes down, but it's tipped out to center by Stauffer as he went down. Shot back in now by DeVoe. Driven around behind. DeMagno couldn't get it. Here's DeVoe trying to trap it, but it glances off his skate, and it's cleared out to center by Seaver. Now a pass on the right side. Here's John DeVoe moving in. Left circle, puts it out in front, and it's picked off. And Stauffer goes to the right corner. Tried to clear, but it's held in as Edina keeping the pressure on. And now brought out by Jennison. Knocked off his stick, but Seaver carries on at center. Drives it in, but he got it up high, and it went over the glass and into the crowd with exactly 12 minutes remaining in the game. There's a break in the action. The score, Edina 4, Rochester 4.
Elegant atmosphere, exciting menus, superb wine list, and affordable dining is waiting for you at Stone Wings. Stone Wings, Bloomington.
From the faceoff, Rizzut fires it across the Rochester line. It's cleared by Smith. And Rochester driving it in now to the Edina zone in the right corner. It's played off the boards. Glenn trying to hold it in and does. He runs into a check from Mike DeVoe, and now the puck is frozen to the boards in the Edina zone to the right as it's tied up by Williams and Rizzut. Face off to the right of Jim Lozinski. 4-4 tie with 11:43 to play. Long shot through traffic. Lozinski smothers a backhand whack that whipped Johnson, rather.
The pace of the game has slowed down for the first 3 minutes of this period, Al. They just seem a little tentative on both sides. They're not skating with the same kind of freedom that they had in the first couple periods.
Johansson and Chapman facing off. Back comes to Mike DeVoe, clears the center. Glenn waiting for men to get onside. Tried to shoot it in. He hit Johansson. Now Johansson tying up with Cassid. The puck comes back in the right corner. Chapman around behind, picks it up on the left side and clears it out to center ice. Smith's pass is picked off. Here's Mike DeVoe moving in on a pass from Carroll. Puts it in front and Smith intercepts, and out he comes on the left side. Smith over the North Star line, rather the Edina line, fires it in and it's wide to the left and offside, and we'll have a faceoff back outside the blue line with 11:10 to play, and there's a break in the action. The score is tied, Edina 4, Rochester 4.
Now, just when you need it, the home sale at Target. You'll discover bargains for all around your home. For great savings, shop the home sale through Saturday at Target.
From the faceoff, the puck in the Edina zone. It's fed out to center ice now. McCarthy relaying to the right. Getting back. McCarthy ready to score. Oh, what a nice play with Roth. McCarthy feeding Roth and getting it back and going in and beating McCauley just inside the left post low on the ice.
You called it, Al. What a play by Roth as he really handled the puck well and got the pass over to McCarthy to score the goal. Here's a look at it. McCarthy, this is the tail end of the play there where he scores the goal, but really what set it up, Lou, was McCarthy's pass.
Well, they had a couple exchange of passes before they got in the zone. McCarthy to Roth, and Roth right here makes a nice pass right back, right in front of the defenseman's stick. He pulled him away, so McCarthy was able to come in all alone and beat McCauley as he came out to him down low.
4:02, the time of the go-ahead goal, 5-4 Edina. Now here's Grosso, back in, putting it in front. Lamb, a backhander, and that is deflected. We'll have a face-off as they puck those out of play. The face-off to the left of the goaltender, Lozinski.
Well, Grosso gave that pass across to Lamb. Lamb tried a backhand shot, and Kacid just got his stick on it and deflected over the glass.
Wick taking the faceoff now for Johansson. The puck comes out to center on the right side. John DeVoe picking it up off a linesman. His pass hit a skate and goes rink wide. DeVoe chasing it, but Wick is there first. Backhands it into the Edina zone. Lozinski sweeps it in behind the net. Members of both teams after it. A centering attempt. Blocked in the right corner. It's still in that corner. Down goes an Edina player. Baker gets up. The puck shot around behind, and on the left side, Cutshell has it. Cutshell clearing to center. It's shot right back in off Wick's stick. And now cleared out by Edina defenseman Rizzut. Here's Johansson from his own blue line. His pass is blocked. And back come the Hornets on the attack. Cutshell on his off wing. Moving in left corner. Stopped there and now pinned to the boards and tied up by Johansson. And we'll have a faceoff to the left of McCauley with 10:02 remaining in the game. It's 5-4 Edina.
16 there in the green. Cutshell made a good move there as he came into the Rochester zone. He tried to go around the defenseman, he couldn't. Rather than pass that puck and give it away blindly, he just took it in the corner and he throws it and he got a faceoff there.
From the faceoff, Rick moving to center ice now. Loses it at the blue line and Maley takes it over for the Hornets. Works by one check and then runs into another. Got stopped cold in his tracks and now Baker fires it in deep to the right. Picked up by Smith, a long pass. Rizzut intercepts at center, plays it off the near boards back into the Rochester zone. It's cleared to center by Glenn. And now it's shot back in by Brower to the Rochester end of the rink. Glenn behind the net, chased out to the right by John DeVoe, runs into Carroll in the corner, and Carroll pins Glenn with the puck. And they'll face off now to the right of McCauley. 9:24 left.
Well, Carroll just getting a line change there as Maley had already gone off, and he just forced the line change now. Wally Chapman and Mike DeVoe come out. Mike, undoubtedly a brother of John DeVoe, the right winger on Maley's line. Even looking skater-like right there.
Yeah.
He must be brother.
On the face-off, the puck comes in front. Here's Carroll in the right circle, blasting away, and it winds up along the boards to the left, and caroms all the way back deep in the Edina zone to the right. Cassid chased back of the goal by Grosso. They tie up. Lamb taking the puck, tried to center. Carroll blocked it. Cassid clearing up the left side. Lamb got it back to the blue line, but the point man had peeled back into the neutral zone. And now a pass is picked off. And here comes Chapman. Got by one man right in for a shot and beaten at the front edge of the goal crease. And a fine save by McCauley. Carroll got upended out in front of the net. And we'll have a face-off in the Rochester zone to the left.
And some more great moves by number three of the Edina, Chapman. What a game he's playing, and what a hockey player he is, Louie.
Real fine hockey player. He likes to use his speed. He goes outside continually. He should every now and then just get a change on that defenseman and move to his forehand on the inside. But he made a good play there, getting a good shot on McCauley.
Rochester clears from the faceoff as it shot down the ice by Satterdalen, but we have an icing call, and they'll go back for another faceoff to McCauley's left. There's a break in the action. The score, Edina 5 and Rochester Mayo 4.
Lamb, incredible ice machines.
Back live at the Civic Center with a score 5-4, Edina leading. 8:49 remaining in the final period.
From the faceoff, it's cleared by Mayo. At center now, it's at the blue line. Stauffer lost control of it, and we have an offside call.
That's it. Played that very wisely. Stayed right outside that blue line and made Rochester come to him. He never allowed the forward to gain the zone and force that offside call.
Now the puck back in the zone. Cassid fans on a bouncing clearing attempt. It's in the right corner. Seaver back to the left point. Glenn's shot is gloved by Lozinski, and he holds it.
Looked like Lozinski was following that puck right through the maze of players, and when he grabbed it, he just sort of says, I gotcha. A fine shot from the point man, Glenn, but Lozinski saw it all the way and just held on to it with the Rochester right winger standing right there, ready to bat it home.
From the faceoff to Lozinski's right, a backhand shot is into the traffic. Here's another chance by Beck. That's blocked. Beck again, back out to the right point. Held in by Smith to Beck in the left corner, puts it in the slot area. It's knocked away from Seaver. Beck back to Seaver in the right circle. Lost control, steals it from Picotti, then loses to Picotti. Stauffer almost stopped him. They can't get out of their zone. And here's a pass that goes in the left corner on a backhand feed by Seaver. Stauffer has it, right circle. A centering pass goes rink wide. Glenn moving in off the left point. Leaves it in the corner, it's fed to the right circle, relayed to the left point, back to the right point. Here's Smith setting up and shooting, and Lozinski grabs it home again.
Well, Rochester doing a fine job, and Beck's had an outstanding night tonight, forcing the play, getting the puck, controlling it, making some passes, and Rochester able to control that puck for about 30 seconds. They had a couple of opportunities, but finally the shot from the point was held by Lozinski, and Edina wants a line change.
Now the puck comes right to Lozinski from the faceoff to his left between Mealy and Johansson, and they'll go back and do it over.
This Rochester team doesn't quit. They just keep coming at Edina, even though they're heavily underdog.
They have
underdog.
Plenty of time. Johansson tried to feed the point, blocked by Cutshall. It's still in the zone. Now John DeVoe picks off a pass and then goes down just outside his blue line, as he is checked there by Navagno. Now here is John DeVoe dumping it in, and a nice intercept just inside the blue line. Coming back on the play to pick that pass off was Brad Johnson, but it's an offside against Edina. We'll have a faceoff outside their blue line.
Don't forget, coming up immediately following this game, Bloomington Jefferson, the defending champion, against East Grand Forks.
Edina gets possession from the faceoff. Brower firing it in. Knocked down and cleared out by Jennison. Edina getting possession. It's played in by Mealy, but he fell going after the puck. It's cleared to center and now shot back in offside by Cassid.
The referees are doing a fine job, Al. I think they're really allowing the kids to play. They're not calling any foolish penalties. The game's been cleanly played. Some very heavy checks, but No needless penalties taken by either team, and the referees have it under perfect control.
Terry Abram and Bill Hocking are the men presiding in the striped shirts in this one. Now Jennison firing it in from the faceoff. Brower coming back of the net, being pursued. Pokes it ahead on the right. Mike DeVoe, a relay to the left. Here's Carroll to Chapman. Shoots. Save, and off the glove apparently into the left corner. Comes on out to center. And picked up now by Brower inside his blue line. Dumps it out to center. Carroll feeds it in over the line. This is Mike DeVoe. Left circle, trying to work in front. A centering pass and nobody home. It's cleared back of the net. And Mayo in possession. A bank off the boards. Comes out to center. Cassid unable to control it as it was deflected past him. He comes back into the right corner. Back of the net now to Carroll, coming back on the left side. Carroll dumping a pass and hit a skate. He picks it up himself. Now his pass hits another skate, going off DeMagno. In the corner, Brower falls. Rochester keeping it in, back at the point. Jennison holding it in right on the line. His pass is picked off, and Brower comes out. Rink wide to the right. Here's Chapman moving in, left circle, dumps it in front, and out comes McCauley to sweep it away. And Rochester attacks at center now. In over the line they come, a centering pass by Johnson, and it goes rink wide to the right. And starting up comes Roth on a 3-on-2 over the line. He's got McCarthy trailing. Roth moving into the left, and a good defensive play by Magno. Poke checks it off his stick. Magno picking it up in the left corner. Clearing around behind. It's Vacotti playing it back behind. Now on the left side, it's frozen to the boards by Jennison as he's bumped along the wall by Roth, and we'll have a faceoff with 5:39 remaining. There's a break in the action. The score is Edina 5, Rochester Mayo 4.
This Minnesota State High School hockey tournament is brought to you in part by Northwestern Bell, who reminds you you can save money by direct dialing your long-distance calls.
Wally Chapman had a few good chances there. He's an outstanding hockey player, and oddly enough, he's a goaltender in soccer, and a very good one at that.
The Zoot shot hits the traffic and goes wide to the left. Glynn behind the net in some trouble. There is Vacanti tying him up. Vacanti goes to the corner, now runs into Lamb, gets the puck back as Lamb was poking at it, works toward the slot. Vacanti battling every inch of the way, puts it in the left corner, is cleared to the point. Rizzuto, a shot, he scores! He went off the skate of a defenseman, I think it hit Smith.
It sure looked like it did, as he was moving over to cover the man in front.
I think you're right, Al. When we look at it again on the replay, maybe we can pick it up. As Edina now leads it 6-4, with a shot by Rizzuto. Here it is. Now let's look closely and see if we can pick up and see if there was a deflection out front. Right there. In fact, there was, off the defenseman, in past the goalie, McCauley.
Well, Hugh Smith was moving over to take Vacanti, and as he was, he saw the puck coming. He wanted to control it. He stuck his leg out, and goaltender McCauley had no chance on that at all.
The goal is unassisted by Rizzuto. A tough break for Smith. He was trying to trap it on the skate, but he didn't get enough skate on it. He just had an angle that caused the puck to deflect off the skate, and the goaltender was moving to his right toward the shot, and the shot therefore deflected back to his left, and it beat McCauley on the opposite side to which he was headed. Play underway. Brower at the Edina line now, overpassing John DeVoe on the right. The puck into the Rochester zone is cleared to the blue line, and the attack is underway. Mayo down by two. Lamb feeding it to his left. Moving in now, Williams puts it back in front at the right point. Smith with a shot, and it deflects up off the goaltender Lozinski. It's Brower going to the left with it, feeding for DeVoe, but it's picked off. Glynn moving in, tried to center, and broken up nicely by Maley in the slot. Maley in the right corner with Glynn battling. The puck comes loose now, and is cleared by John DeVoe out to center. The Spartans have to wait for men to get onside. Now Smith dumping it in. Lozinski back behind for the cutoff. Members of both teams after it. The puck fed into the right circle by Rochester. DeVoe picks it off to Maley now. A return pass, reaching back for a good reception. DeVoe comes in and gets whacked by Jennison in the left corner. Jennison losing his stick. The puck cleared to the line. Williams has it. Williams working to his right, lost the puck, and here's DeVoe coming back in. Overpasses Maley, and Rochester clears to center. Back in now for Baker. Got by one man and then falls as he was checked from behind by the man he beat, Jennison. And now the Mayo Spartans attacking again, but the puck is cleared out of the Edina zone by Rizzuto. Shot right back in. Lozinski steers it to the left circle. Rizzuto clears to the boards. Carroll there, and he feeds it out on the right side. Mike DeVoe over the line, passing back on the left, a loose puck, a race for it, held in by DeVoe, who gave it to Baker, who fires it around behind into the left corner. Now Chapman goes after it, takes the man. Mike DeVoe tried to get control but couldn't, still battles for it. Back at the line, Rizzuto again with a shot that's wide left, rebounds to the right, it's brought back of the goal by Brad Johnson. He's checked, and the loose puck at the right, they bang at it. Carroll tried to knock it in, but he's blocked off by the goaltender McCauley. And now it's back at center ice for Wick. Wick stopping as he runs into Baker at the Edina line. Baker is checked by Johansson. The puck comes back in the neutral zone, and now a long shot by Smith is blocked by Lozinski. Puck brought back of the goal. Rizzuto pulls away from Wick, feeds left. It's relayed to center ice by Vacanti, and picked up in the neutral zone. Rochester Stauffer firing it in off the near boards. Coming back for it, Rizzuto, rounding his net with 2:35 left. Edina with a two-goal lead, 6-4, as the pass is fed to center. In over the line, McCarthy leaves a drop pass now. And on the play, Roth was tied up. The puck brought back of the goal. And Rochester attacking on the far side. One man all alone. A lot of trailers, and it's broken up in the Edina zone, and back comes Roth now to McCarthy. He's got a man, Vacanti, coming on the left. The pass to Vacanti, got it out of the skate and scored! Good play, Vacanti. The pass to McCarthy was into his skates, but he managed to work it loose onto his stick and went in to beat McCauley to make it 7-4. Good goal.
Well, Edina coming alive here in the last part of the third period to overpower Rochester Mayo. They now lead it 7-4. There's just 2 minutes and 4 seconds left to play in this game. And watch McCarthy, number six, coming up ice. Nice move. It bounces off of the stick, goes across. Svakani, number 11, puts it in past the goalie. And Edina leads it 7-4, Lou.
McCarthy tried to pull his puck through Smith, but the defenseman knocked it right over into Vicani's cage. He makes the good play, kicking ahead to his forehand and beating McCauley. It was a 2-on-1, and McCarthy thought Smith was moving over Vicani. He was going to take the puck, but Smith sticked it right over to Vicani, and he put it away.
Vicani from McCarthy and Roth is the scoring play. There's 1:57 remaining. And Edina leading by 3-7-4. Has Edina taken a penalty, Pete? I don't think they have.
No, they haven't.
Not
two penalties in the game so far, both to Rochester Mayo. That's Vicani. His brother Mike was a goaltender on the Edina team a couple of years back.
Sure, I remember.
At University of Minnesota. John DeVoe apparently had something wrong with his chin or checking underneath his jaw there, and that's why he went off the ice. Getting a line change here. Rochester Mayo probably has had more shots this period than he had in the first two, but Edina's pulled away from him. A fine play originally on McCarthy's goal to start the period off, then a deflected one off a Rochester Mayo defenseman, and now a play right there, good play by Vicani, puts Edina ahead by 3-7-4.
Puck comes into the Rochester zone. Jennison back of the goal, clearing it to the left wing side. A relay to center now. Grosso dumping it in for Lamb. It deflects off a stick. Brower missed it, but it's cleared out to center right. Here's Mike DeVoe now to Chapman. In over the Rochester line. Booms off a shot that goes wide to McCauley's left. Chapman checking Lamb in the corner. Puck comes back out to center ice and in control. Back at the blue line is Brower, who fires it off the boards into the Rochester zone. DeMagno picking it up behind the goal, runs into Carroll. Loose puck taken by Lamb now to the right of his net. Lamb starting to work out. 1:10 left. Rochester needs three quick ones. Here's Lamb in over the line, blasts away, and Lozinski makes the save. With 1:05 to play, and Edina leading 7-4, they'll face off to the right of Jim Lozinski. They got the Jefferson Jaguars coming up against the Green Wave of East Grand Forks next. In game two of the championship round. Johansson coming out to take the faceoff for Rochester. Got it back to the point, and a shot by Whitney is blocked in the slot area, and out comes Edina shooting it from center, broken up at the blue line. And now Mike Roberts on for Edina, takes a long shot. Blocked. It's loose at the right side as they try to work it in front. It deflects up in the air and it lands behind the net. And now it's fed on the left to Satterdell and it's center ice. He was tied up on the play by McCarthy and the loose puck driven back into the Rochester zone by Roth. Glynn behind the net. Brad Glynn fakes right, comes left. Headman's on the wing now. Long pass by Whitney off the boards on the far side. And it's cleared out of the Edina zone by Roberts. Tied up in front of the bench as Maley gets into a little pushing match.
Maley, one of the three centermen on this Edina team. Wally Chapman, Maley, and McCarthy. Big reasons why this hockey club has had an outstanding season. They get great center ice play from all three of them. Chapman, an outstanding skater, puck handler. Maley, a good passer. McCarthy just looks like he's going to be a fine player himself. He does both. He skates and handles that puck extremely well.
Good burst of speed. John DeVoe getting to the puck first. Tried to center and hit the back of the goal. And now we have a little display of ungentlemanliness. A few frustrations apparently being taken out, and we have a penalty against Mayo.
Well, Dan Lohr going off for a penalty for charging, but he really did lay a nice check on the Edina wing there. Dan Lohr not seen as much action today, but he hit that man with a real fine check beside the net.
14:54, the time of the charging call. 6 seconds remaining with a face-off to the right of McCauley. And Edina will go on to the second round of the championship, the semifinals here Friday night. The puck back in the corner, flipped up high by Jennison at the horn, and that's the end of the game. The final, a victory for the Edina Hornets, who overcame a very stubborn.
There is 1 second left, though, Al, and I think they're going to try to play it. There's 1 second left on the clock. The horn sounded prematurely, I think, and now the officials are going to try to play off that one last second.
Well, so, if they must, they must. Anything to make it legal.
I'm sure Rochester Mayo is just saying, let's get it over with. Mayo outshot in this game by Edina, 38-20, Luke. Final 7-4. Lou, Edina advances on in the championship round, and Rochester Mayo drops back into the consolation bracket.
Well, Mayo put it themselves very well. They came in, they were underdogs to everyone. Edina, of course, number one ranked in the state for most of the season. Were heavily favored. Mayo fought all the way. It was tied after two periods, but Edina's speed up front and their size and a relentless checking finally paid off for three goals, and they beat Mayo 7-4. Edina with great, great play up the middle. I think that's their strong point looking at them here. They've got good playmaking, good speed, and some outstanding players like Chapman and Maley that really make things happen when they're on the ice. And McCarthy, I thought, had an excellent game.
Some people thought that if Edina could just get by that first game, that they would be in great shape to go on and win the championship. Well, they've gotten by that first hurdle, 7-4 over Rochester.
Well, I think it's a little early to talk about championships because they're going to have their hands full with the winner of the next game.
And, of course, later on tonight, two more games. Henry Sibley against another pre-tournament favorite, Hibbing. We'll go on the air at 7 o'clock with that one, and then Cloquet versus Mariner. But, of course, more hockey action this afternoon. Bloomington-Jefferson against East Grand Forks coming up in just a little while. That's the end of the game with the score, Edina 7, Rochester Mayo 4.
Checkmate. Checkmate by Good Sports. Get the ultimate in mid-body protection. Thighs, kidneys, and hips fully protected by lightweight Checkmate. With the fit you can customize. Good Sports shoulder pads mean super protection of the AC joint, sternum, and collarbone. Join the hockey revolution with Good Sports, the ultimate in protection. Get Checkmate and all the other great equipment from Good Sports. Good Sports hockey equipment is available at better sporting goods stores everywhere.
Chevy's out to blow away the confusion about pickups with the new Chevy S10. Let's compare mileage. Ford's late-entry small truck can't match S10's EPA gas mileage ratings.
They don't offer an optional V6. S10 does. Ford can tow only 3,000 pounds. S10 can tow 4,000 pounds. Compare cargo box size. An S10 is longer and wider. The new size Chevy S10. There's never been a truck like it before.
KSDP News Time, 7:23.
If the Reagan administration has its way.
Ray Scott with sports coming up.
Our sports at this hour.
Good morning, Americans.
Good morning, this is John Farrell.
And I'm J.B. Eckert.
This is Frank Setapani at the news desk of the Wall Street Journal.
KSDP's radar, weather, and traffic coming up.
Traffic on 35.
Catch up to your world and its happenings. Wake up to news the minute you want it. All news in the morning from KSDP, News Plus Radio 1500.
The Bobby Smith Kemp's Ice Cream Hockey Clinic.
Puck carrying is probably what I do best. Practice. Learn to handle that puck without looking at it and move it side to side with flexible wrists. When I'm playing well, I feel I can make that puck do just about anything. Come on, let's go.
The Bobby Smith Kemp's Ice Cream Hockey Clinic has been brought to you by Kemp's, makers of Kemp's Ice Cream.
Well, we finished our first game of the afternoon. Edina beating Rochester Mayo by a score of 7-4. It was an exciting third period. We were all tied up, Lou, going into it 4-4. And at 4:02 of the third period, Edina scored to take the lead, and they held on to that lead throughout the rest of the game. Look for number 10, Rolf, to number 6, Mike McCarthy.
What a great passing play coming up the ice. McCarthy and Rolf, probably made the as good a play as you can make when he passed that puck right in front of the defenseman's stick, putting McCarthy in all alone. Right, watch this, right in front of the blade. So he's got the defenseman right out of position. McCarthy coming in, a fine shot down low, beating McCauley.
Then a break for Edina at 9:43. Look for number two. Rizzut shoots from the point, and the puck will bounce off the defenseman's skate into the net, and that gave Edina a two-goal lead.
Well, the defenseman there was going over to take Vacani in front of the net. He saw the shot coming. He wanted to control the puck, and as he put his foot out, it glanced off his skate. McCauley already moving to his right in case Vacani would have got the pass. Was beaten. He had no chance in the play.
Did it 12:56. A two-on-one break. The puck bounces off the defenseman's stick right here. He had a good idea with a pass anyway.
He certainly did. And Vacani made a great play getting that puck in his skates and then getting control and scoring. The last two goals that were scored, here you see the pass going across. Actually, it came off the defenseman, Hugh Smith's stick, and Vacani scores the goal. But Cassitt, on McCarthy's goal and on that goal, made two real nice plays coming up the ice. Number five for Edina fed that puck right up the middle both times, starting both plays, and that's how Edina resulted in two goals for them.
Well, Lou, standing by downstairs with the winning coach is Ed Caro. Eddie?
Yes, and with Mike McCarthy, who had a terrific game, and pretty exciting for you being here first time, huh?
Oh, yeah. I've never been here before. It's first trip.
That was really a piece of precision, that winning goal. You obviously have drilled hard all year with those line mates, and you and Roth just clicked today.
Oh yeah, we work a lot of drills like that in practice, moving it back and forth, and sometimes it works, sometimes it don't happen just right tonight.
Well, as you know, Mike, this guy has been a familiar face to us over the years here at the hockey tournament. Ike, congratulations and welcome back.
Thank you. It was an exciting first game. We knew we were going to be in a hockey game, even though we did beat them in early February. They were a fine hockey team, a fine skating team, and we did defeat them 6-2, but that was no indication of the game. The shots were even, and even today's game, boy, that second period, we kind of stormed them, and nothing happened, and then we got a few breaks, and the puck went in, and when they scored right at the end of the second period, it kind of took us momentum away from us again, but geez, we came back in the third period, and we've done this all year. We've been a good third period team, and we've scored them in bunches, so we're just happy to able to be playing tomorrow, Friday night at 7 o'clock.
Well, congratulations to you both. Thanks for stopping. And Bob, let's go back to you.
Thanks, Ed. So Edina wins. They'll meet the winner of our next game this afternoon, Bloomington Jefferson against East Grand Forks. That coming up in just a little while. We've got much more for you between games, and we'll be back with that after this. The 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament continues after station identification.
Thatch can choke a lawn to death. Of course, you can remove thatch by messing up your lawn with a power rake or messing up your back. Or you can use the self-propelled Snapper Hi-Vac with the economical thatcherizer attachment. It plucks the harmful thatch from the lawn, then vacuums it into the grass catcher for easy disposal. The result is a beautiful revitalized lawn. And it's also great on the Snapper Hi-Vac Rider. You and your lawn come out in great shape. Snapper, discover the difference.
Bacon cheeseburger, medium rare, lettuce, tomato, onion, and ketchup. Big, ice cold, frosty Coca-Cola next to it. Look at that, huh? Perfectness. This is real refreshment, real big taste. Now see, if you were another cola, number 2 or number 29, you'd do taste tests and challenges and stuff and try and compare yourself to this, wouldn't you? Sure, don't shake your head now. You would too, you sneaky devil. See, that's why they call this the real thing. Yes, it is. Coca-Cola is it.
Every year, students from around the world come to live with American families through a program called AFS. It's a year of growing and changing, good times, even some hard times. But one of the hardest times of all is having to say goodbye.
Surprise!
Hey, you almost missed your own party. Mama, Oyata,
Adaru. I love you too, Dad.
For more information on AFS, call 800-526-7443.
Channel 5, KSTP-TV, St. Paul, Minneapolis.
We now return to the St. Paul Civic Center Arena and the 1982 Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament.
Back live at the St. Paul Civic Center, awaiting the start of our second game this afternoon between Bloomington, Jefferson, and East Grand Forks. You know, each and every year that we televise this tournament, we like to have some of our friends from ABC, some of the many stars that appear on programs throughout the week on Channel 5, visit with us. And Jeff Meyer is standing by downstairs with Ted McGinley of Happy Days.
Thanks, Bob. I'm down here by the ice now with Ted McGinley of Happy Days. Ted, it's a pleasure to have you here. How do you like the tournament so far?
Thank you very much. I'm having a great time.
a lot of very nice people here, and I'm being introduced to hockey at the best level I think possible.
Well, I think it's kind of nice that you don't have too many more people here that like you. How do you feel about that? You're a young guy. How do you feel about the recognition?
I love the recognition. I think anybody would. I think it's a very natural thing to have happen, but I enjoy it as if every time I go out on a trip and I get recognized, it makes me feel so good. It's a great feeling.
Now, you've been on the show about how long?
Well, I just finished my second season on the show.
How does it feel going on a show that's been so successful for so long? Were you a little intimidated going on with the people you work with?
Well, I was very intimidated because I remember as a child sitting home and watching Happy Days and thinking, oh, that's the greatest thing on earth. It must be great to be on TV. And Henry Winkler, to me, was the superstar of superstars. And so when it was time for me to step up and work with him as a contemporary, I was very nervous and it was a bit intimidating, but they were very nice about it, and they really helped me.
Now, you maintain that you're learning a lot. How did you become an actor initially?
I was in New York working as a model and studying acting just a bit, and Joyce Selznick came out on a talent search to New York, and I did a screen test. The screen test was sent to California, and next thing I knew, I was on Happy Days.
Well, Ted, congratulations. You're doing wonderfully well on the show, and thank you very much for coming out to the Minnesota State High School Hockey Tournament.
Thank you.
Hope to have you out here next year. Back upstairs, I guess, huh?
Thank you, Jeff. You know, it's time once again to check in with our roving reporter, Rob Lear. He's at one of the busiest places in this entire arena and one of his favorite places, and that's the concession stand.